Okay, Z, hello, how are you? Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Just Enough Heshy Show. We have an interesting show for you tonight. I'm going to introduce my co-host since Esty's on vacation. You know Esty's on vacation.
Yeah, where'd she go?
She went to Colorado or stuff like that. Oh. I think there's a lot of stuff going on there. They were telling him. And yeah,
I think there's a lot of stuff going on in Colorado that she would like to partake in.
So I'm going to introduce my co-host, Z, my handsome, good-looking young. Single man.
What's up, everybody?
Z, and Neil, my voice of reason, cannot be heard today because he's not here right now. I'm hoping that he shows up shortly.
But we have a special guest coming in at 8 o'clock, actually.
Yes, we do. His name is Naftuli Moster from Yafed, a very interesting man. He is for education, secular education in all schools, but forget
including
about
the including Hasidic.
Especially the Hasidic. Yeah. And there should be no discussion even on that.
It's a very hot topic over there because I know that they're very against it.
And maybe they should lose their funding. And so we're going to listen to what's going on. Yesterday, we had a very interesting subject, Z, about
What did I miss?
Giving gets. We had a young lady here for 11 years who didn't get a get, but a Rabbi Stern, wonderful man. The man is just like an angel. I mean, I didn't even know how to thank him for all the help that he did for this woman. And still...
There are many
out there. Even one is too many, Z. Even though I was making a little bit of light of the situation, like, oh, look at most of it. Truth of the matter is, one is too many. You know, somebody should not be in bondage or have a problem or something. But they did come up with some very good solutions. Post-nuptial, prenuptial agreements.
There's a thing, there's a halakhic prenup. I think you probably talked about
it. And he said you can get it online free. They're very good organization services. Anyways, everybody, as you know, I start my show with a little quote. Z's going to have to make his comments since Neil is not here.
I'll do it gladly.
Thank you, Z, for helping him out. And I have a very inspirational story that touched me so much, Z, that I think I'm going to get to you today. And this quote is a very simple quote that I have for you today. And I'd like you to hear it. I'd like you to enjoy this one with me. It's about truth, everybody. If you would be a real seeker after truth, it is necessary that at least once in your life you doubt, as far as possible, all things. Change is not a threat. It is an opportunity. Survival is not the goal. Transformation is the true success. That means I know you all believe, I know you all have trust, but you know what? Change. Change for the good, change because we all mess up. And that is what my story about this today is about. And I want to tell you a very interesting story. In the Bible,
I've heard of that book.
Okay, I know that everybody knows this. It says people often fail to recognize the power of their words. And the responsibility to use this power with care and compassion to the others. Your Bible or the Torah or it teaches us that God holds us responsible for the pain that we cause to other people. In the very first dispute in your Bible, in our Bible, between two human beings, Adam's son, the first man, his son Cain kills his brother Hevel. When God is in his effort to find out what's going on with Cain, he tests him, even though he knows what's going on, where's your brother? And Cain responds, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? And God answers him, what have you done? In this rebuke, God is telling Cain, you are your brother's keeper. And had you treated your brother as a true brother, then you would never have spilled his blood.
Do you think a lot of people know the background story of Cain and Abel?
It's not even the background story, but my speech is tonight to you is that you are your brother's keeper. You do have to have your words of wisdom and you have to be kind. You have to be very careful how you talk to the other people. You have to be very careful that when you do something bad out there and you rat them out and you want to save your soul, yourself, and you let everybody else go down, it is unforgivable. And I'm going to tell you a story that I actually felt the pain today of this man. There was a young man, a beautiful man with his wife, and the story is very simple, that he had it all. He had his business. He was up on top of the game. He had it all. He had money. He had friends. Beautiful baby boy, 6, 7 years old. A beautiful daughter, 14 years old. Things were going smooth. One day he gets a call from his wife on the phone, And he says, hey, I have an emergency. And the secretary tells the husband, like me, you know, my wife calls too, hold. And she goes to the husband. The husband says to him, I can't talk to my wife now until I'll call back. And the wife and the husband, the secretary comes running into the office. Sorry, it's an emergency. She's flipping out. You got to pick him up. He picks up the phone in the middle of the meeting. And the wife says, if you don't come home now, everything is over. Your son is dying. He gets into his car, he runs home, and he finds out that his son has an incurable disease. He's dead. He's going to die. It's a rare form of a disease and a big trouble. Anyways, the father goes to his doctor, and he stops their work, and they go to the doctor, and the doctor says, listen, your son is in big trouble, but there is a doctor who works on these diseases, and we believe he can cure your son. And the guy says, where's the doctor? Go to Boston. The father gets into his car. He takes his wife and his kid, and he drives to Boston all night. He sets up a hotel, sets up an appointment, and he waits in the lobby. And he sits there an hour, 2 hours. And he figures, you know, this doctor is going to come out like any doctor, a great doctor, and it'll be warm and nice. And the doctor walks out to him with vicious cold eyes. And he says, I'm sorry, mister. And let me call this guy Mr. Green, for example. I'm sorry, Mr. Green. I will not help your son. Get out of my office. And the father says to him, what do you mean? You can't help him? They say you can help him. He says, I want you to know I can help your son. And I could save your son. But I will not do it. Get out of my office. He says, what are you talking about? You're a religious man. I'm a religious man. Help me. Look, I have my prayer books. He says, I want you to leave my office. And he starts crying, this man. Please tell me why. Look, my son is here. And he says, you don't remember me? And then he calls him by his Jewish name and calls him Yossel. How do you know that? He says, let me tell you. I know who you are. Please leave my office. And he says to him, please, you got to tell me, no, no, no. And the doctor was like very vicious, get out, get out, get out. But the doctor said to him, at the end, the doctor broke and was, you know, something's when you hate somebody so much, you do want to tell them why you hate them.
All the time.
And he tells him, he said, listen, I'm going to tell you the story. You are a little boy. My son was your friend and you tortured my son. You bullied him. You didn't let him play with you. You abused him in class. You didn't let him be part of the gang. You made him hate us. You made him hate us so much that he didn't want to finish school. And he started to get closed up and pressured. We tried to work with him. We tried to help him, but nothing would help. And he just gave it all up. And then me and him used to fight. And about 5 years ago, he picked himself up and he left. He became not religious. He left the family. He told us to drop dead. I haven't seen my son in 5 years. Because of you. Your mistake, the way you used your words, the way you treated my kid, I lost my son. Now go lose your son. I don't care. Get out of my office. The man took his wife and kids and started crying. He left his office crying. He knows now he's dead. This is the man that can save my son. Look at the one mistake I made many, many years ago. A few mistakes. And I used my words incorrectly. And I didn't take care of the younger, or the weaker, or bullied him around. I now lost my whole life. And the man went home to the hotel room crying. Now, the way the story is told or read to me is that the man went to bed crying, praying, and all of a sudden, now don't get nervous with me, Z, but his grandmother came to him in a dream. And his grandmother says, listen, I want you to get in your car, have faith, and drive to Maine. And he woke up and he tells his wife, I got to go. She says, why? He says, I had a dream. I can save my son if I go to Maine. She says, what do you mean? I'm going to Maine. I have nothing to lose. I lost my son. He's going to die. I'm going to go to Maine. He gets in his car and he drives for 5 hours. And he gets to Maine. He pulls into a gas station and he goes over to the guy. He says, listen, I just came into town over here. I'm going to ask you a question. Can you direct me to a synagogue or a kosher place? And the guy says, listen, man, there's no Jews here or whatever there is. There's no kosher. There's no synagogues here. And the guy says, really, you sure? I'm telling you, I feel it. He says, listen, there's nothing here for you. Nothing. Go home. There's nothing. Go whatever you want to do. Anyways, he says, he starts pestering the mechanic. And the mechanic says, hold on a second. And he calls this guy from the back. He says, hey, Robert, get over here. And Robert comes from the back. And Robert sees our guy, Yossel. And he looks familiar. And he says, oh, my God, Robert, you're Reuven. You're the guy. You're the doctor's son. He says, oh, my God, it's you. I hate you. Get away from me. I don't want to look at you. And he starts crying to this moving guy, this Robert guy. Please, please, I need to talk to you. He says, if you don't leave, I'm going to call the police. I don't want to know you. I don't want to see you, what you did to me. Get away from me. Get away from me. Now, these are grown men already. You understand? Things of the past. He says, get away from me. I don't want to know you. Get away from me. And he starts screaming at him. And he gets on the phone. He calls the police. And this guy also gets in his car. And he drives back to his hotel room, crying all the way, praying to God. He found the guy. Somehow God showed him in the right direction. He sat all night crying with his wife. His wife says, listen, let's get back in the car and drive back. Let's take the kid. Show him the story. He says, what do you have to lose? Another few hours? They get in the car and they drive back the 5 hours. They get to the mechanic shop. They go ask for Robert or Ruvain. And the guy doesn't want to come out and he's begging, he's crying. And Robert comes out, says, listen, I told you to get out of here. He used every explicit word. I don't want to see you. I don't care. And Yossel starts crying. And somehow he was able to convince this guy, Robert Ruvain, look at my son. He's dying. Please listen to me. Give me a few minutes of your time. And even this man who was tortured and abused or whatever what happened to him, he says, okay, what do you want me to tell me? He says, my son is dying. Nothing could help him except one person, your father. He says, okay, what do you want from me? I don't talk to my father. I hate my father. Even if I do forgive you, what do you want from me? He says, please, please, not only do I want you to forgive you, go talk to your father. He says, but my father hates me. He says, no, he doesn't. He says, but even if I go there, why would your father help you because of me? He says, please, I was found this path. This story is crazy, which I also believed it was crazy when I read it. But the guy says to him, okay, you know what? I will do it for you. I will do it. He goes into the car. He tells the father of the young man, let's go. And they start driving and he tells him, pull over. Pull over. He sees a barbershop. He goes into the barbershop. He cuts his hair. He gets back in the car because he had long hair. He was dirty, a mechanic, you know. He was just a bum. He didn't want to be part of anything religious, footsteps, nothing. He didn't want to know nobody. They get in the car and he asks Yossel, he says, do you have an extra yarmulke? And he says, yes, I do. He takes the yarmulke, he puts it on his head, he takes a clip, and they continue driving. They go all the way to the father's office. They all go up to the father, all four of them. And the guy comes into the father's waiting room and he stands before the secretary. And the secretary sees the doctor's son. Couldn't believe it. And she starts screaming, oh my God, oh my God. And the doctor hears a commotion in the back room. And he comes out. He says, what's this commotion? And he looks and he sees his son there. And he breaks out into tears. And he grabs his son and hugs him and kisses him and hugs him. And they both start crying and tearing and holding on to each other for, I don't know, 20, 30 minutes, I'm told, if not longer. And they're crying. And they sit there and they start talking. He says, oh, Father, I know what I did to you. I know I left you. I know what happened. Please forgive me. I don't know what we did. I don't know why we had this fight. And the father says, I'm sorry I threw you out. I'm sorry I argued with you. It wasn't worth nothing that I had all this money, all this thing, all what you did. I agree. I accept you the way you are. And the son says to the father, listen, I know you're upset with this man. I know he hurt us, but it's time that we all forgive. Take care of this boy. Save this baby's life. And the father took the baby and did the treatments on the son. And the boy lived to live many, many years and still lives today. Then somebody else told me the ending of the story gets even better. That this guy, Ruvain, went back to school, became religious again, went to Israel. He was introduced by this, the kids who was dying's father to a rabbi who had a sister. They got married and they have children and they raised a beautiful family. So what I'm trying to tell you here in the story is very simple. I know it was a very nice, heartwarming story. It touched me. It hurt me. It made me cry a little bit, not cry because I'm a man, you know, I hold back my tears. But here's the deal, my friends. You are your brother's keeper. You hurt somebody, you put him in jail, you rat him out because you want to save your soul. If you're more important than everybody else, then just remember, it will come back to haunt you. There is a circle, there is a world that you will be punished. Yes, I've also had times where I've been hurt and I wanted to get to other people and I've said bad things and I think I've been punished. I've also lost my place in life and my amuna or my faith. I'm not here to preach. Yeah, and I heard Neil rant and rave yesterday and scream. I'm not ranting and raving. I'm going to tell you very simple. You are your brother's keeper. I don't care if your child wants to go off the path or does want to go off the path. I know your kid did drugs or not did drugs. I know that we are here to help our fellow man. Rabbi Stern yesterday, wow. I don't know how you do it, man. You are something special. You are an angel helping these women in distress. I don't know why they go through this thing, whether God set it up for them or not. This is my deal that I hope to God, I hope to whatever power, I hope whatever you people believe in, do good, be good to your fellow man, and be kind. Now that we have the show, can I tell you a little stupid joke? Because now that I made everybody sad, I want everybody to laugh a little bit.
Any joke that you say is automatically pretty stupid.
Okay, very good.
Don't worry.
So here we go. And here's my joke. A guy goes to one of the basketball games. This is something for you. The NBA basketball finals, the famous seventh game of the finals, which is like the World Series or the Super Bowl. You know, most of my listeners don't care, but this is it. The guy is sitting, gets tickets to the final game from a friend, and he's sitting back a whole bunch of rows, and he sees during the game that there's a seat open right in front. Right in front, by, you know, I don't know what it's called, the courtside seats it's called.
Yep.
So he figures, what can he go wrong? He goes and he walks down to the courtside seats, and he sits down, and he looks at the guy next to him. And the guy next to him says, hey, you know, that's my wife's seat. He says, oh, wow. I'm sorry. Can I sit over here? He says, I want you to know I've come to every single of these games. I've bought these seats, and me and my wife sit here always. And tonight you couldn't come. And yeah, you're welcome to the seat. He says, wow, it's such a great seat. It's worth so much money. Your wife couldn't come. Couldn't you bring somebody else, your kids or something? He says, no, I wish I could have, but they're all at her funeral. You didn't get it.
I heard this joke when I was 10 years old.
Okay, so it was a funny joke that some people won't give up stupidity for. Anyways, everybody, you're listening to the Justin of Heshy Show. Esty, my beautiful Esty, is not here to help me. Neil is not here to help me. Z is sitting there hungry, screaming at me that he wants something to eat. Hi, so I'm going to tell you, wow. This is your Justin of Heshy Show with Uncle Heshy. We're on Monday and Tuesday nights from 7 to 9 p.m. You can get us on Facebook at Justin of Heshy. You can get us at Twitter at hashtag Justin of Heshy. Or you can see our show live, all the previous recorded shows, by just typing in Just Enough Heshy. You can also email me for any of our advertisements at justenoughheshy@gmail.com. That's just enoughheshy at gmail.com. You can call into the show and talk about anything you want. 718-303-9090. This guy, Rabbi Naftuli Moster, is going to be coming on the show. We're talking about education.
It turns out I actually know his brother, a friend of his brother. Yeah. So somebody figured out who it was, and his brother might actually be listening to us on YouTube.
So this is a very interesting person we're going to have tonight. So we're going to hear what he has to say. So he'll be on from 8 to 9 o'clock. So everybody tune in and you'll be ready to call in and speak to him. Remember, we're going off the air. Our season one ends. Our last show is on September 8th. And season two begins on October 12th. So if you get bored and you don't know and you need to see the Uncle Heshy Show, what you're going to do is you just go to YouTube and watch a whole bunch of previous great shows. Our show tonight is sponsored by Mr. Clean. Pick up and delivery and drop off. You get 25% off if you mention this.
They're dry cleaners, by the way.
They are dry cleaners. Well, it's Mr. Clean. Mr. Clean Dry Cleaners. You call him at 347-369-3051. A wonderful man. He's been doing great work for me. I've been using him exclusively. And trust me, I used a lot of cleaners through the years. Also, we have Black Label Electric Cigarettes, which you can see on YouTube that I'm using. That's BL Boy Larry Premium, PREMIUME Cig. SCIG.com or call Mike at 561-239-8941. By the way, Z, he's still not married. He told me he'd be married in June and July. He's still not married. We have to do something about
it.
Mikey,
isn't it?
Mikey, we're selling you cigarettes. Let's go. Also, don't forget to call Greenline Building Solutions. We have asbestos and lead inspections, DOB, HPD code compliances. We help you lift stop work orders. We do inspections, free consultations. And you call us at 718-871-0382, 718-871-0382. Again, call into the show, 718-303-9090. Ask us any questions. We're going to be talking about a lot of stuff. I want to fight with Z a little bit at Donald Trump. But
I have a topic I wanted to bring up at some point.
Z, we didn't take a lot of calls yesterday. Let's take a caller to start the show.
Already? What are they calling about? To tell you how bad
your joke
was?
Let's find out. Hello, caller. You're on the air with Uncle Heshy and Z, not Neil tonight, so nobody's going to control us.
Hello.
Hello, how are you?
Yeah, I just want to let everybody know that I love the show.
Thank you so much. Wow.
Is this Heshy's wife again?
No, I wish it was my wife. She didn't like the show the other night when I was finding my boy. How are you calling? Where are you calling from, by the way?
Brooklyn.
Good for you. My town. That's the way it's supposed to be.
Mm-hmm. How did you hear about the show?
My friend told me about it.
Have you listened to watch a couple of our previous shows?
Yeah.
What do you think about any of our previous shows?
I mean, love them.
You're good. You're very good. Did you like that show about footsteps, by the way? I had a lot of people screaming and hollering at me.
Oh, no, I didn't see that one.
Okay.
Well, you can go watch it on YouTube. It's archived.
I'll do that right now.
We're on now.
Right now, you stay with us on the show. But very nice of you. I'm very happy you gave a call into the show. Any questions for us, or you don't really care about us?
No, I just like to hear.
You got it. Always tune in to our show. Tell your friends about it. We're on from 7 to 9 p.m. Monday and Tuesday nights. Thank you so much for the
Thanks
call.
Thanks for the call.
I love the show. I love it so much.
Wow. You just made my night and Z's night because Z's hungry and I don't know how to keep him quiet. Thank you so much, my darling.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. It's so cute. Take care.
I don't care who was it. It was one of our listeners, and you didn't want to pick up a call, Z. I have
made their whole night.
Z, I have a question for you.
Yes.
Okay. And I have two questions for you.
Two questions.
Wow. One,
going to start charging.
I want to ask you about Donald Trump. The guy, everybody says he's leading the polls right now, even though this guy Bernie Sanders is coming up very good on him right now.
Yeah.
I don't think Donald will hold after what he did yesterday. You know what he did yesterday? He goes on the air and he says,
Every day he has something else.
Right, but yesterday, I think he blew his whole campaign that I want all illegal immigrants out and their children have no right to become citizens. How could he break the Constitution? According to that, then gay marriage doesn't have to be legal because he doesn't want it. Did he just blow his whole
I feel like the fans of his that are going to vote for him are like all this stuff. Like, he could say pretty much anything at this point. And the people that like Donald Trump and would vote for him regardless. He could stand up there and say that the sky is not blue and everyone will just still be like, okay, it's fine.
But they
like these crazy ideas and they like the fact that he's basically nuts and that he's making a push to change things and that he's, you know, like the voice that everybody, you know, he says things that the people are afraid to say, but they really agree with him.
But let's be reasonable. He has the Congress to fight. He has the Senate to fight. You have to push through legislation because you get up as president.
It doesn't matter if it happens. The fact is that it shows where he's holding as far as his mentality towards how he's going to treat certain issues in the country. But I believe he's right. Somebody does have to make a stand against illegal immigrants. It's ridiculous.
I disagree with you.
You know what happens if you try to sneak into any country in Asia or Africa or any Middle Eastern country, try to sneak into Afghanistan. You know what they'll do? They shoot you. Why are we the only country that it's like, well, the border, like, okay, you know, we're okay with it. Some people get to come in, some not.
But this is America. That's right. The beauty of America. Do you know
we went through this already.
I know that. But
we welcome immigrants legally. There's a way to do it.
Immigrants, at least when they come here, they work hard, they pay their taxes, they want to be part of society. Do you know that one out of three Americans are considering leaving America because of the taxes and so on? So you're telling me they're going somewhere else? Why should we not keep our population flowing? Why should we? I mean, we're not having more children. We don't have billions of people here. We have a couple hundred million people. It took us 200 something years to get to this point. And you know what? We have a lot of room and we should build America. We should have the immigrants work hard.
Controlled. There was just a case in Florida 2 days ago or 3 days ago where an illegal immigrant killed a whole family of people.
Well, we talk about there was a case 2 days ago with Morgan Freeman, his granddaughter, a wonderful, beautiful girl. Her boyfriend went crazy and stabbed him on the street for exorcism. So what do you mean? Why didn't we stop Morgan Freeman's great-grandparents from coming here because his grandchild is going to kill somebody? You can't say that because one or two out of 300 million people.
A lot of them come in looking for criminal behavior because this is the place where
there's criminal behavior everywhere. You have people doing criminal behavior in Europe. You have criminal people.
So we should screen who comes into the country. So take a look at them, see what they have to offer, see if they have a job lined up, see if they're going to be productive members of society and not just come over the border and do whatever the hell they want.
Don't you think give them a chance over here?
Yeah, give them a chance. They could take a number and
screen them. What is screening? We do screen them.
Exactly.
You know the process.
The legal ones.
And you know what do you mean legal? How do you become legal? You have to apply for it. You have to wait years. Yeah. You have to be poor and suffer.
That's how.
Why can't I? And you know if you have
it's
money.
It's not a charity. It's a country.
Exactly.
It's a country. We have a country to run. We don't have to worry about other people.
A country to run. A country means that the country means of people. It's not just your land or your honor or rip down the flag. Everybody's fighting today. Rip down the flag of the Confederate. Forget the flag of the Confederate. This is a country that is mixed people. We want people.
Yeah,
we
but there has to be some sort of control because otherwise it turns into chaos. Well, maybe we shouldn't have police because, like, hey, everyone should be free to do whatever they want because America, it's free, right?
It's not free, but that right. We don't have crime. But yes, everybody should have
to be control and limits.
No, police should not have a right to stop you and frisk you and tap you down.
I didn't say that either, but there has to be some sort of enforcement. It's not a free-for-all. It's a country. You can't just come in from whatever country and just do whatever you want.
So we have a set of rules. You know what? You want right. to come into America. No
follow the rules.
But there are the rules. Come to America border. Show us your paperwork or submit it before that you're coming. Tell us that you're coming and let them in. But you guys don't even have the rules. We have to sneak over the border because when we try to come in legal, you turn us down.
Because they don't contribute anything.
What do you mean they don't contribute? Why does anybody have to contribute? America is the point is where you want
to. So it's a charity? Everyone just comes in and we give them free things?
It's not a charity. It's a place to make yourself a better exactly. life. So, to get a better life.
Right.
We
so
give
come
away,
in.
One minute, we give away billions of dollars to other countries. We give away...
Which I disagree with, by
okay,
the way.
We give away billions of dollars to the United Nations, to other countries to give away. We give arms to other countries that not only our enemies, but our friends as well. So we're sure. playing both sides of the game. You know, this other idiot on the television the other day was saying, Barack Obama has lowered our army and Air Force and Navy to the lowest point ever. Are you crazy? We have, I think, 12 or 16 battleships out there. You know that? The whole world has maybe 11. We have more than the whole world combined. And you're worried about our army and our armed forces going down? We are the most powerful army in the world. We're out there. When we fight the wars to lose, it's because we don't really want to win. That's the truth. I think these generals are playing a game so they can make more money and a job.
Let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
Do you think that if we pulled back all of these, you know, military things that we have, all these bases around the world, and other countries knew that we weren't really paying attention to what they did, you think that the world would be as peaceful as it is now? Or a lot of countries know that if they start misbehaving, there's going to be problems.
Do I need now an army base?
What do you think?
I'm going to tell you now.
I don't know.
Do I need an army base in Germany because it's a center spot yeah. for me? I don't. I need it.
Strategically, it makes a lot of sense. What if Russia attacks here and we're 4,000 million miles away? We got to have somebody.
Well, we pulled out of Afghanistan and we prepared them with a military, their army. We gave them all the forces. We pulled out of there. We pulled out of Iraq, set them up that if we need them, hey, we'll come visit you and we'll come use you because we're buddies, but don't make me be there and spend the millions and millions of dollars. And you know, every time we go there and we leave, we have to leave all our stuff behind because it doesn't pay to bring it all home.
Yep.
So we're spending billions and billions of dollars, which we can feed the poor, take care of our immigrants, educate our immigrants, which Naftuli Moster will explain to you,
yep.
that a lot of our own people are not educated. Why? Because we don't want
Listen,
to educate
people
them.
Say the same thing about NASA and about space exploration. Why do we need to care about what's on the moon when we have people dying in the world, right? But at some point, there's a give and take for everything.
Do you know that now they came up with a new stupid thing for $11,900, they will take your ashes and put it on the moon?
People are actually doing that?
That's what I was reading. I mean, what stupid people want to put their ashes on the moon?
My question is, how do they even know if they did it? I would be like, okay, yeah, we put it on the moon. What, right. are you going to go up there and check? Free $11,900.
I don't know. Just to have your ashes that don't exist afterwards, might as well just give your body to science if you think it's, you know, if you're just going to throw your ashes in the air to be part of the world. And perfect, you were born over here. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a lot of crazy people out there. What should I tell you? I'm sorry. I don't know.
Like I said, everyone always makes that same argument. They go, whoa, everyone in America is immigrants. Why is everyone against all these illegal immigrants? And the difference is that there is a legal way to come into the country. And unfortunately, we don't have the resources to just open up the borders and say, everybody, come in.
But America
has to be controlled.
But America is so much red tape that even with your legal way, it makes people suffer.
But why is that our problem?
By the time
this isn't like a business.
By the time they become citizens, they're 40, 50, 60 years old. I know a citizen now, a guy, a nice gentleman, I think from one of the islands, and he was here for 30 or 40 years. His kids are doctors. He served in the thing. He just now became a citizen at 70.
But why do you feel everyone has this like right to be an American? It's because they want to be.
Because that's what
it's our, a God-given right. If they're born in Europe, they're allowed to be Americans.
But that is what our Constitution. You see, don't you understand? That's the principle of the basis of this country, the Constitution.
And there's a legal way to
become a legal citizen.
So you want to spend more money and open up more immigration and you definitely can't just say illegal immigration is okay, because then literally anybody will just walk across the border. Even you would admit there has to be some sort of control, right? You can't just say, here, America, everyone, come in.
Well, we have to watch that people who are coming in have IDs.
That's
we
what I'm saying. Exactly.
But if they have the proper identification, do you know how much paperwork they have
I
to
don't know.
To become?
I know it's not
it's
super easy.
It's a process of years and
so
years and years.
And I'm sure part of immigration reform is reforming the fact that it is hard for people to come in.
No, immigration reform is they're just going to make it even more look, you know what? You know, if today if you get arrested in jail and your family is local, okay? You have a family here. You did a white-collar crime. I know a guy who did a crime 11 years ago. I'm not even saying, and an email was went out today to Felder and to Greenfeld and to Hyken, one of his local boys. The boy did something 11 years ago with somebody else. We're not saying that he was not guilty, He got a year and a half sentence in jail. Instead of the prison sentencing him over here, he had to go to Rikers. He was shipped out 8 hours away near the Montreal border where nobody can go visit him twice a week. And you know, the red tape to get him back is a whole year just to get him close to his family. By that time, he'll be out. And happens to be he's a Jew, so he can't even get his kosher meals or his synagogue. He's in jail. He's entitled to some rights in jail. But the point is the red tape is so complicated for one of our local American citizens who did something wrong. People do serve their time. People do get in trouble. To get him through all this hardship took forever. And they're trying to do reform for the for convicts. They're trying to reform the prison systems. It takes years and years and years. By that time, our whole generation is gone, you know?
Okay, but again, you're making it sound like it's some sort of God-given right that everyone has the right to be an American. Like, why do you feel that?
I believe that everybody has the God, just like every Jew has a right to be an Israeli citizen. I believe everybody on this planet.
You think Israel has open borders?
Israel
they
has.
They have a very controlled system, much more than us. It's a huge safety issue.
Israel and Canada don't make it that complicated. You come, you sit down with your paperwork, we meet you, and in a couple of months, you fill out your paperwork and you're in.
Yes, because they don't have 20 million people trying every single day. They have maybe a couple thousand here and there because it's not such a big country.
I don't know about that. America can control it. They can say, listen, man, they could deny you or go get back your paperwork. Mm-hmm. The point is the guys who want to get into this country who are
so your whole argument is for immigration reform. That nothing to do with opening the borders
and
for illegals.
Forget about immigration reform. Forget about it. Don't even open the borders for the world. You want to protect your borders? Is better fine, but the people that I hear now, the people that I hear for sure do not take away their children's citizenship, for sure not allow them to become citizens and members. Give them a trial membership plan. Say, listen, we're going to give
trial
you,
membership. Yeah. What is this, a magazine?
It's a country. Listen, you want to? Right, Dave.
What if it doesn't work out? See, they're working out. I mean, if something doesn't work
anyways,
out here, it means that they
anyways.
Did something very bad.
No, not true. They just didn't qualify. No, no, not true. There's a whole bunch of guys in Los Angeles. They run around, these guys running around all day long, arresting these people all the time. And these guys have jobs. They're working. Yeah. They're doing nicely. 8-10 years. They get captured. They get sent over the border.
Yeah.
What do you mean? What do you mean? Yeah, the guy was good for 10 years. He should have passed everything.
You're right. I agree
and
with
still,
you.
So where's your line? Where, because of the red tape and the law and the code, and I didn't take my test on time, so I lost everything. These are stupid, stupid, stupid things.
I agree. Know. I'm not arguing with you, but to say that everything should be open is definitely unreasonable.
Well, I don't know, my brother. I disagree with you. I disagree with Trump. I think Trump is another, what's that idiot's name, Bloomberg, another bubblehead, and I hope to God he doesn't win the Republican nomination. And if he wins it, Hillary will beat him. But I believe that Bernie Sanders is up and coming. And
a lot of people think Trump is going to drop out at any moment.
That's what he does. Trump, once he sees the numbers going against him and there's a chance for him to lose, he doesn't want to be embarrassed, he's going to say, oh, I made awareness, and here you go, it's all yours, everybody else.
You think that's embarrassing to lose a presidential campaign?
Especially for Trump, who's a billionaire, who has the money. There's no reason that Trump should not win the election based on money. Most presidents win because they have the funding behind them, and you're a good speaker. And Trump supposedly is a great speaker. Not only is he a great
speaker, he is a good speaker.
He has a television show. He made classes on how to buy real estate, and he charged big money for it. So he is a public speaker. He is a television star. He is presentable. I don't believe he has any class. I don't
he's a little rough around the edges.
Rough? I think he's very rough around
the
edges.
By the way, I saw some article, I forgot who wrote it, but that a lot of people, when they think about the fact that Donald Trump will be in charge of nuclear weapons, all of a sudden it gets a little bit more real and scary, you know,
nuclear weapons, you just can't make that decision. The way I understand is that even though you have the power of the button, the president can't do it alone. He has to have permission.
No, he
has to have the secretary and the other people to type in the number. You need other people around you.
Not necessarily.
To push that button, you still need your clone.
The point is, do we want this guy controlling the fate of the world and nuclear weapons and the army? It's not so simple. I mean, I agree with a lot of his principles, but like I said, I don't know if he's really...
I don't think he's going to
make it. I think he's a little bit too rough around the edges.
And you know what? I believe he's just going to raise taxes to solve his problem, raise the prices. He's going to just do things the way he wants. That's what they do. You know what I mean? He's a guy who goes out to get the best, bargains to the lowest price. In America, he owns a big budget and a nice little treasury, so he does not going to care to spend as much money that he wants, because not anymore is he a billionaire. He's a trillionaire because he's going to control the budget.
But I think his philosophy of making people work for their money is pretty good. Sorry. I like it.
Anyways, everybody, you're listening to the Just Enough Heshy Show. You can call into 718-303-9090. We're on till from 7 to 9 p.m. Monday and Tuesday nights. You can get us on Just Enough Heshy. Neil has texted me that he'll be here momentarily. Oh, please, Neil, where are you? I'm very upset you're late. Esty didn't call into the show, but I'm sure she's having a great time doing whatever you said she's doing.
Whatever she's doing in Colorado.
Have a great time, Esty. Enjoy yourself. But she'll be back next week, regular time. And what else? And we're going to have Naftuli Moster, Moster on the show again about education. What do you believe? Do you really believe that all these, I mean, these young Hasidic
boys, honestly,
I was hearing an argument today in my office. Who do you think you are forcing education down
before
our throat?
Before you ask me any questions, I just want you to know that I don't feel that I'm qualified to answer because I don't understand the way their community works. Now, as an outsider, I think, yes, of course they have education.
I'm not talking to their community. I'm talking to you right now. Did you go to elementary school?
I did.
Did you go to high school?
I did.
Did you graduate?
I did.
Do you think that you could have gotten anywhere in life if you didn't go to high school?
No. That's basics.
Reading, basic stuff.
Basics.
A lot of these guys don't. And it's not that I have a problem. They go to welfare, food stamps,
If you don't have a high school diploma, you're pretty much worthless. But most of them don't ever need it.
Why?
That's the whole thing.
So that's what I was talking about. Our community takes care of itself. We'll have no problem getting jobs.
Because for the most part, it's true.
It's not true.
It is true.
And you haven't seen
it. There are the fringe here and there that are not working, but for the most part, their community seems to be doing pretty well from where I could see.
Okay, so then the problem is that you haven't seen. I have a friend who, by the way, his name is Moish.
That's what I'm saying. I'm not qualified to speak about it.
Friend,
I don't know.
My friend Moish Lipa went into the hospital, and he, thank God he got out today.
Let me ask you a question.
And I was sitting in the hospital. I'm just telling you right now. And I didn't see one layer, but I saw three. You know how everybody, you know, they have these little rooms in the emergency room where you can go into them. They had three layers thick out that people weren't even in emergency. They were laying in beds in the hallway, in the walkway. That's how it was. And a lot of these people were Jewish, and a lot of them were poor. They didn't have the insurances or had the medical insurances. They couldn't go to their doctors. And because they're not educated, they didn't have the proper jobs. What do you mean taking care of our own? They didn't take care of
their own. Let me ask you a question before anything. What is the reason why they are against education? Is it because, is it like
it's a waste of their time?
No, I'm saying, is it because they don't want to secularize?
They think it's secular to learn secular education?
What is their reason?
If that is the reason, then they're idiots. I believe that their reason is they feel they don't need the education.
They're not idiots. That's how they believe.
No, they believe.
You could agree with it or disagree with it, but they're not idiots.
I believe that they're wasting their time in English. I believe that they're wasting their time. You know, there's a lot of Spanish and Chinese people. They don't need to believe in the English for their children, go out to work with. A lot of them want to educate their children. I have Spanish people working for me. I have different multinational people working for me, racial people. You've got to help them get educated. You know how many kids I told go back to school, work with me, stay with me?
But again, you have to understand why they're against it.
It's not just because they don't want it. They have a reason. No, there is no reason.
They have a reason.
No, it's not a good enough reason.
For you.
No, I'm sorry. Not for me, for anybody. We're going to take another call. Hold on. Hello, Jose. You're on the phone with Uncle Heshy and Z. How are you? On the radio. How are you?
Hey, Uncle Heshy. Nice to talk to you. And I enjoy your program. And I'm glad that you're giving me the opportunity to get on the air and talk to you.
Thanks so much. Appreciate that.
Thank you. As far as the immigration issue goes, I think we should remember that this is a nation that was founded on immigrants from all over the world.
Legal immigrants.
As far as it was, you know who was here first. And We opened the door. We opened our hearts to everyone that came here, giving your tithe, your poor, and all of that kind of good stuff. And the founding fathers, you know.
But they still went through a process at Ellis Island. They came through. They got processed. They got screened to make sure they weren't sick.
And what was the process? 2, 3, 4
Whatever,
months.
Something.
Today, immigration. Immigration takes years.
We're arguing. We're not arguing. It needs to be reformed.
No.
But you can't say that it should be illegal.
As it goes on time, they keep making it worse and worse. These politicians think they know better.
I'm with you.
I'm just telling you today, these politicians don't care about nobody but themselves. They have a young man sitting.
Where are you from, Jose?
Yeah.
I was born in the Dominican Republic, raised in Brooklyn. But at first, when the continent was found, when America was found, there were the documentations. And to go a little further, in 1945, when the Second World War was happening, the doors were open when Jews wanted to find a place, somebody to let them in. A lot of these continents, a lot of these little countries opened the doors for the Jews that didn't have anywhere to go.
We agree that we should open it up. We just think that there has to be a legal process, and you can't say that it's just an open border policy that anyone can come and go.
It comes a time in society with everything that's going on, with the displacement of so many millions of people and everything that's going on with the economy and wars all over. You know, we are, in a way, responsible because we have the world in turmoil with all these wars, okay? Which I got injured in this last Gulf War here. And to say that there's no room now for other people that are struggling in their country and they're trying to find a better way of life.
So you're an Army veteran?
I was in the Merchant Marine.
Oh, well, thanks.
And I got injured. Service. Thank you, I'm not a hero, but to say to close the door for other people that are, you know, in their own country are finding themselves with so much corruption and every type of corruption that you could possibly think of, freedom of religion, freedom of the press, all kinds of freedom that's being oppressed around the world, and these people are looking for a better life. I think that we should rethink on the way we are doing things and
make it easier for them.
And open our arms. Be our brother's keepers. That's the theme of the night. Be my brother's keeper. Make sure they get educated. So, help them become better men and women.
Jose, I'm going to assume you're not voting for Trump this year, huh?
it's something to think about and if he replaces some of the things that he's saying.
Right.
He's a viable candidate, but as far as attacking the Mexican today, he's attacking the Mexican. Who's saying that tomorrow he won't attack the Jews or he won't attack the people from El Salvador or the people from Colombia?
Yep.
You know what I mean? So we got to be careful with this thing and see what how it's going to develop. And we got to look out for each other. Like your friend was saying, Uncle Z, you got to be my brother's keeper.
Yeah.
And this is the way we got to do it. And no matter what, you know, we're all in this together. And we got to pull it and make it a better place for everybody.
That was very well said.
Jose, I want to ask you one question.
That was a great call.
Jose, you are a good call. I want to ask you one question. Do you like Hillary or not?
Hillary is fine. Like I said, with a little bit of polishing. I think if we all pull together, we can make this nation a greater nation. And I still, no matter who gets in, it still be a nation of immigrants, no matter what, because there's people from all over the world here, and we got to look out for each other. And those that want to come in, they should go to the due process. But still, those that do get in any way that they can to find a better, you know, better place for their family, they should be allowed, and the case should be looked at. One by one, and if we need to hire more people, I think we should hire more people.
Speed up the process, 100%.
You are wonderful. Thank you, Jose.
Thanks for
the call. You're a good man. Keep listening to my show, Jose. Don't disappear on me.
I sure will.
Thank you so much.
People are passionate about this, especially people that come from other countries.
It's not only come from people whose ancestry comes from
other countries.
That's
what I'm saying.
And people who have families in other countries, they need it over here. I know that these borders should be open. I know there's a lot of con men in any game to help them. But if we trick them and we, you know, right now, drugs, marijuana, which I'm against, you know, we're doing illegal stuff to make this happen. Once we legalize it, Let me just tell you something.
Before 2001, you know, September 11th, it was a lot easier to get away with all these loosening the border kind of things. But now, sadly, we live in a world where we have to always have that in the back of our minds, that if we loosen things up too much, it just makes it very easy for people to come in that want to hurt us.
Those stupid terrorists that killed us, those 19 animals, they would have gotten in no matter what.
They had the money, they got the power, they had the paper. You still have to make it harder for them to do that.
If you know the system and you know how to forge documentation.
You can't let people into this country without at least some sort of check.
See, the point is, of course, you can't check the big guys. Even though you think with all the computers and the background checks, you could trick your way into this country. You can smuggle your way in.
Some yes, some no.
Right. But
the, people get busted
I'm talking
every time.
About the regular little people. Right. Yeah. You know, I hear the stories of all these.
They have to use their judgment and see. Exactly.
We have a lot of red tape that we make people suffer. There is not enough people to take care of it, but there is enough people to fine us, to punish us, to put us in jail. You know, we had a caller on the show a couple of weeks ago. I'm happy to arrest people. I love to put them in jail over the last 40 years, Michael Cutler. I speak to the president. I mean, what kind of a man loves to put, I know that he does good. Don't get me wrong. Yeah. He did stop a lot of drugs. He did work with the DEA. Don't tell me he didn't do good. But to enjoy hurting other people, not understanding. You know, you have a lot of these judges who are just animal pigs, you know. I met a criminal court judge the other day, and I started to argue with him, and I know him for many years. And I said to him, I understand you. You know, you just follow the letter of the law. That's not acceptable. You have to have compassion. He says, no, you're wrong. I do talk to my victims. I do talk to my defendants. I do tell them to try to do the drug rehab. I do try to give them one or two chances. I do try to help them out. You're right. Sometimes there's no help in it. I do try to consider everything. He says, no, I don't just lock away and throw away the key the first shot. Everybody's entitled to another chance. A lot of these judges don't. They want to just build their ranks up, serve their 30 years. I met a cop who just did 20-something years or 18 years of his time. He was tired. He cut his hand. He cut his finger. And he gets triple pension, whatever it is, or three-quarters pension. And that's it. That was his life. He's happy. And whatever he accomplished, he didn't really care about doing good. There are some people who care about the community. Yeah. Some officers they love. I met a couple officers the other night. They came. They helped me look for my car. He stood there.
Yeah.
He smiled.
Many policemen get into the business because they genuinely want to help.
They want to help. And some people just vicious.
They
you can't
like
blame
bullies,
the cops.
Just like
right, you heard my story. People do grow up. People do change. You're right. I know you're going to scream at me and Neil would scream at me. You have to forgive. You're right. Sometimes people hurt me. You know, I like I told you, I had a personal tragedy. Something happened to me that I lost everything, that somebody screwed me. I can't forgive this guy. I know that the world will come around. I know it will come his time to get him. And I know that something will, that God will punish him, because that's my only recourse, that God will get him. But my point is that's my belief. But not everybody does believe in God. Everybody comes to me, oh, God will help you do this. Oh, thank you. You're such a good man. God is going to bless you. I said, listen to me. Stop that. I know my job. I know what my duties are. And everybody's preaching that tomorrow. I want goodness today. Be my brother's keeper. If you do believe in God, be my brother's keeper. I know a man that feeds 92 families every day. I know another guy. Matter of fact, my friend Penny was screaming at me the other day. He says, oh, this guy, he just talks big. He doesn't help anybody. And then I put him on the phone today with the guy's sister. Yeah. Oh, he takes my calls. You're right. He can't always get everything accomplished, but he helps us. He brings me food. He helps me. He tries his best. He makes phone calls. He's there to console me. This is a man who works. I'm so proud of him. I want to say his name so much on the phone. A guy that I talk to daily, that WhatsApps me every morning. Good morning, Heshy. How have a great day, Heshy. This is a good man, and I want to say his name so much. I call him Uncle Ephraim, but he's a wonderful man. And there's not. And sometimes he asks me to do something, and I don't do it for him, and I feel embarrassed, because these are people that are the brother's keeper. They go out of their way to give up their whole life. You know. And that's it. Let's take another caller. We got another 10 minutes to the break, so we're going to take another call. Hello, you're on the air with Uncle Heshy.
Hi, Heshy. How are you doing, Rich?
Hey, Mitch, hey. How are you? How are you doing?
Mitch, what's up?
By the way, I just wanted to compliment you. Just a superb show yesterday. If anybody did not get a chance to hear or see it, definitely go into the archives and check it out. It was fantastic.
Thank you.
I missed it. I have to hear it myself.
I brought two wonderful guests up, and they didn't know they were, you know, Mitch, they both didn't know they were coming on the show at the same time till they got it.
Surprise.
It was wonderful. Now, obviously about immigration, I have a specific thing that I think would work well in terms of at least trying it. You know, Jose, your last call, interesting enough, he does something. He's a merchant marine. Here's my question to you, and a question to everybody out there. How about the idea that if a person wants to come to this country, wants to be an American, wants to, you know, get all the privileges of that to be American, how about service? How about joining the armed forces?
That's not fair. Now you're asking them to risk their life.
Why is that not fair? You know, when my father, God rest his soul, was still living, he used to be drafted. It was proud. It was patriotic to be part of our great system. We now have a volunteer army, the best of the best. Now, what is so wrong that if I want to come to the United States and be a patriotic American, that I do my best, that I say, you know what, I'm going to join the Coast Guard. What is that? And then I'll give you, and then because of that, I'm going to give you automatic citizenship. How about that?
Okay, Mitch, so let me give you another
thing. What about a 50-year-old woman?
Yeah, and Mitch, you know what, I'm going to tell you something else.
All right. 50-year-old woman? Okay. She has to go through the process. I'm not saying it isn't good. But what if she has a son?
Okay, but Mitch, I want to interrupt you. You know, I know you guys don't like President Obama, but he had one great line that I keep repeating over and over, and it gets to me. He says, and he says very simple, he says, service to your country is not just serving in the army, but to serve your fellow man. If you can't
go. All right, but there are other services. All right. I'm not saying that
service to be a teacher, service voluntary, food lines, go work the government, clean the streets. There's so much to do. You know, in my synagogue, we have a Spanish lady. I don't know where her background is, maybe Mexican or whatever it is. She's been with the synagogue, I don't know, more than 20 something years. Her children, I remember when they were born, they're big, they're beautiful, educated. She cleans for us. She takes care of us. When you should see when we make a mess and we make her suffer, she comes back the next day with love. She makes sure the lights are on properly. And this girl, really, we make her suffer. When it comes time for the Jewish holiday, she comes and sweeps up. She makes it look nice. She plants a little fruits and vegetables in the front of the synagogue. This woman, it's not only for the pay, because I don't think they pay her that good, but this lady goes out of her way. That is service that she takes care of. When the old people come, she makes sure their wheelchairs are properly put away, and she's nice to them. She cleans the bathroom to make sure that even though they make a mistake, she doesn't make a comment. Sure, everybody has a bad day. There's so much to do service. You know, I have a lady that's been with me for 20-something years, that when my wife went through a tough time and I went through a tough time, has helped me raise my children, never misses test, has been more to me and my family than my brothers and sisters. That is called service to your country. You don't have to serve the armed forces. Serve another family. Help somebody.
Actually, now that you've gone on your pedestal, let me just say, I agree with you. You see, you didn't let me finish. When I said service, I gave that as an example. But what about people who want to become, let's say, American, and they can do stuff in the inner city? They can, as you said, they could possibly help neighborhoods, job corps. There's a lot of voluntary things. You don't have to join the military. That was just my feeling. But you're 100% right. What about people who want to become an American, but we want them, for example, to clean up, to clean the cities, to do things which are positive to all of us.
Right, they can join you now. We have so many people that we run the government so behind it. We keep hiring more people, and we keep making them pensions. I'm telling you, we put them into different government agencies instead of paying so much high payrolls. We train them to be clerks, paperwork, going out to do jobs for volunteer, and we have so it's called internship, just like the Congress and the Senate. I agree.
Actually, I'm sick and tired of more money being put into state governments, U.S. governments, city governments, etc. Do you know how much waste there is with people who have these cushy jobs working for New Jersey or New York, or New York City?
The cop sitting by the toll waving at everybody going through makes $150,000 a year to punch his balls all day.
What they do when it's time for them to retire, what they do is in their last year they put in overtime so that their pension is worth more than the president of the United States in terms of salary. So to me, I'm talking about voluntary work. You mentioned your synagogue. You met your churches out there. There are food. How about people who do the work of feeding people?
Right.
These are food kitchens. If you can do a lot of hours doing that, I believe you deserve to be get citizenship for you and your family. And by the way, you talk about Israel in terms of accepting every Jew. Well, I hate to say in that case, if you want to be a citizenship of Israel, it's not a matter of me or who you deal about who's the Jew and who isn't a Jew, but also the fact is that Israel expects you to become part of their IDF, boys and girls.
Right, but you don't have to serve in the military. You can do other stuff. You could be cooks. You can clean. You can help with the animals, the farms.
It's not free. In other words, people don't think. In other words, people think that every Jew can go to Israel and that's nothing, and that's it. That's not how it works. Israel wants you to be part of the system. They want you to be respected. They want you to be part of this country that is at war with 22 Arab nations. This is what it's all about. Nothing is free. The Russians who came here after 1970, who now all live in Brighton Beach, those guys, you know, they can talk about all that, about the fact they sucked in the Soviet Union. I totally agree. But when they came here, they got everything. They didn't exactly suffer. I know how those people live. So I'm saying suffer a little bit for your citizenship. That's my feeling. And Heshy, I love you. I love your partner there. Neil, I realize that he still doesn't have, he's still working now because he's got to make a wedding soon. Listen, you all take care of yourselves, all right?
Thank you, Mitch. You're wonderful. Mitch, I want to ask you a question, Mitch.
Yeah.
Can I get you a trivia question quickly before I get you off the air? Here's my question for the day for all of you. What organization was founded in 1881 by Clara Barton? And I'm going to give you four.
She's a nurse, right? She's a famous nurse.
She's a famous nurse. And did she found the Girl Scouts? Did she find United Way? Did she found the American Red Cross? Or did she found the ASPCA?
Well, it's obvious that the answer, obviously, is C.
Correct.
The American
Red Cross. She was a wonderful woman. Thank you, Mitch.
By the way, here's another question for people out there. I always confuse Clara Barton with Florence Nightingale.
Right.
Yeah.
Another great nurse.
Those are the only two nurses that
were where was Florence Nightingale? Wasn't she a nurse in the...
She was a famous nurse, and I always sort of get those two confused.
And you know what? Both of them are special people, and both of them, God reward for the hundreds and maybe thousands of people they've helped throughout their lifetimes.
The Red Cross. Look at that. Look at the great organization.
Mitch, thank you, Mitch. Thank you for your call.
Absolutely.
Tonight. We're coming to the mid break of our show.
Midtown Town.
We're on Monday and Tuesday nights from 7 to 9 p.m. We're going to have a wonderful guest on the show in a couple of minutes. Where you can get us on Facebook at Just Enough Heshy, Twitter by hashtagging me Just Enough Heshy, or you can YouTube me at Just Enough Heshy and watch all our pre recorded shows. You can email me and get our sponsorship, justenoughheshy@gmail.com, or call into the show at 718-303-9090. Our first season ends. Our last show will be on September the 8th, and we're going to season 2 on October the 12th. Again, we're being sponsored by Mr. Clean. He gives you 25% off if you mention the Just Enough Heshy Show, 347-369-3051, 347-369-3051, or Black Label Electric Cigarettes, BL Premium, PREMIUM, eSig.com, Mikey, 561-239-8941, buy 10, get one free, and so on. I'm coming coming to my quote of the Mitch show. So I'm going to give you the quote. And this is for you, Mitch, because you're a wonderful boy. Wisdom, because I believe you're very wise. To make no mistakes is not in the power of man. But from the errors and mistakes, the wise and the good learn wisdom for the future. Well, we'll stay tuned. We'll be right back, everybody. You didn't put his head. Welcome back, everybody, to the show. The second half of the show. Neil, my voice of reason, has finally showed up over here.
I have a doctor's note.
Esty, of course, didn't even call into the show. Well, Evan Z is taking a break. And we did have our guest join our show, Rabbi Naftuli Moster.
Yeah.
And you're from the Yafid organization?
Yafed,
I'm sorry. Thank you for correcting me. And we are going to talk to you. We have a lot to talk about. Neil, as you know, is late tonight. We're going to ask you a little bit about your show. But you do understand that this is the Just Enough Heshy Show. I'm your Uncle Heshy, not yours, but everybody else who wants to listen to us. And everybody.
How do you spell your last?
M-O-S-T-E-R.
And we have Monday and Tuesday nights. I know I said it to everybody again, but I'm going to remind you again, 7 to 9 p.m. Season 1 ends on September the 8th. It was a great season.
Wow. Yeah,
I had a good time. And 70-something shows almost.
We started getting more serious.
So, I know that. We used to be more funny, of everybody.
And we'll get back.
But people are now coming down the street and screaming and hollering at me, so I got to fight back. And the problem is I'm too serious. Then, of course, we have you can get us on Facebook at Just Enough Heshy. You can watch that. And YouTube me at Just Enough Heshy. Or again, just email me and get our sponsors or anything. Or you can watch this show and pay attention to what Rabbi Moster has to say afterwards. And at the justenoughheshy@gmail.com. Now, Neil, by the way, as you all know, I'm going to tell it to you. I have to tell this out. On this Sunday, August 23rd, I run my standard yearly 22nd year in a row, my rafting trip up in Port Jervis. And you look at my Facebook. You're all invited to the rafting. It's $35 per person. And we're going to ask an additional $5 donation we're going to be donating the additional monies to Masbia. It's not going to be much, but whatever we can get out of it, we appreciate it.
I heard they closed in Borough.
Yeah, yeah.
What?
We have $2.9 million a year that our budget is. Do you think it's easy feeding 400 or 500 people a night and on Shabbos? It's tough, so we have other places where to go. We give out food to the widows and the divorced women. We try our best. Not me. Those people, they're wonderful. It's a hard job. It's hard. I know.
It was the first one,
but the other, but Borough Park was a smaller location. They need to expand. The Flatbush and the Queens are better operations, and we are helping people out. I mean, so if you want to come on my rafting,
this is how everything starts. But everybody wants to be the good guy. This and
okay,
that.
You're not gonna let me finish.
And then
telling
all of a sudden, but let's close this one.
You're knocking my mind. I want to tell you about my. If you want to come rafting with me, Z, and you can bring your friends, you can bring your kids from 2 years
old. Can I throw you over the raft?
You can throw. They're gonna try. I'm gonna bring my water cannon, so you're all in trouble.
But they all jump from this rock. That's like what? How high?
30 feet high. To my son, I'm scared of the rock. I'm trying to cut it out of the trip. You come on my rafting trip. Mm-hmm. It's in Port Jervis. We stop after like 2 hours. I have a big gigantic barbecue. As you come out, you have hamburgers, hot dogs, steaks, all super kosher, not mixed with not kosher. Don't worry about it. Footstep people are accepted on my show and my people as well. Anybody wants to come to the rafting trip. You'll have to pay your $35, but the barbecue is free. And if you don't want to go on the rafting trip and just show up for the barbecue and mingle with us, you're welcome. 718-303-99. You look on my Facebook page, look on YouTube or Twitter, and you'll see the directions and the places where we are.
What's your Facebook page?
Just Enough Heshy. J-U-S-T.
Haven't you heard it enough already? You don't know?
Well, we're going to tell everybody. Call into the show, everybody, 718-303-9090. Rabbi Moster, I want to ask you a question. And you are, I just want you to know, my background is a very religious, Hasidic family background. I grew up more modern Orthodox, but I do believe in education. And my... Stop it, Neil. Shut up. I do believe in the Hasidic people.
That's why I love you.
What's the problem?
Because you can be anything.
And why not? Why can't I? What's your problem? It's America.
No problem.
And that's why
you heard me say a problem. I'm smiling ear to ear.
I know that. And that's why immigrants can come here, Spanish, black, yellow, purple, and you can become anything you want. You can become white.
But they have to come in legally.
Listen to me.
We're not open.
But make it easier. Don't make them suffer 5, 7, 10 years.
That's because it's government.
It's government. Right. And the government has to be changed and shut down. So, okay. Moster, I want to ask you a question. I don't understand what's going on here. Do you want education? Don't you want? Should I just send my kid to public school and get it over with? I mean, it's costing me this year. My wife said, with bargaining and all the crying, maybe I'm going to get away with $13,000, $14,000. Maybe if I'm lucky.
That's for one.
Yeah. One kid, and I'm cheap because somebody told me, I met this Dr. Joslowitz today in the hospital, wonderful man. He was helping my friend who had the heart condition, a wonderful boy, a doctor for so many years. He said he was already paying 15 years ago $20,000-$25,000 per kid for private schools.
He's a doctor.
It's not the point. The point is, again, you went to doctor. I'm an immigrant. You know, I'm just a small Ryan immigrant. My problem is that I don't know how you're gonna fund this. You know that Greenfeld is full of garbage with all his voucher program. You know that Hyken has nowhere to be found
Hold on,
let me finish it. You know that Senator Feld is hiding in some corner over there, not saying a word, and how we're gonna educate our children, especially in yeshivas. But he runs around screaming, "Oh, Satma supports me, Bubbev supports me, all these people support me," but he's not educating the next generation. He's gonna retire with a nice pension, both of these guys.
Who did you just mention? A bunch of Hasidim support.
Right. The point,
they don't want English.
And that's my problem. So we can easily buy these guys off with money. And for a few pennies, we can now pocket these money and these grants. Explain to me what you want from us. Tell us what's going on over here. First of all, give us a little history on your organization.
Yeah. We didn't even introduce him yet.
All right. I did. Bye-bye.
Let him tell a little bit.
Right away, where are you from?
I'm originally from Borough Park.
Oh, one of mine. Yeah, I like that.
So I just wanted to say, first of all, I'm not a rabbi, so...
I like to call you rabbi, but no.
Oh, he even calls me rabbi.
I call you rabbi because he shaves.
Just double checking.
I'm sorry, Naftuli. Right. We'll call you Naftuli. How is
all right, that's fine. So first of all, thank you for having me on the show. And I mean, it sounds like you could be a spokesman for Yafed. You know, from the way you're talking about all these politicians and how they're not doing anything about
it. We have Operation Clean Sweep. We want to get them all out of office and put new guys in. Matter of fact, we would like to run you for office, baby.
Oh, okay.
Which you're going to be the president of the United States also.
No. What office am I going to get?
We have an opening seat coming up in the assembly very soon. Hyken, you'd like to run against. And then you live in Queens. We'll find one of those losers to get rid of. There's a bunch of them crooked.
Oh, you know what? What's interesting is we just recently put up on our Facebook page, I don't know if your viewers can see this, but I put up this picture of 12 different people, and I asked, which of these people is helping, is fighting for the tens of thousands of Hasidic and ultra-Orthodox boys to get a better education?
Oh, I see.
Is it a trick question?
It's not a trick question. Just look at the pictures.
I see a Friedlander. Is this Friedlander number 9?
Is one of those, yeah.
And where's Pearlstein? I don't see Pearlstein.
Oh, he's not on there.
Well, two winners that were appointed to the community board by Greenfield and do zero. Actually, what they do is they go for the synagogues who don't want education, and they go fight to get rid of stores, that legal businesses, people who are immigrants who try to do businesses, and they stand over there and call and fight for them.
Let me just ask him a question.
I happen to like Chaim Deutsch. I'm sorry about that one.
Is he on there?
He's on there.
What's so good about Chaim Deutsch?
We had a question.
Oh, my God. There's a handsome guy, number 8, over here. Who is number 8? This guy does everything.
He looks familiar. There you go.
Go ahead. Tell us.
We had a question before. You could probably help us answer it. What is the reason why they are opposed to secular education?
I think this is a good time. Let's actually go take a step back and talk about the issue. Because I'm assuming that many of your listeners have no idea what we're going to be talking about, right? I'm assuming you have thousands of listeners out there who don't understand the Hasidic education system. So let's tell them about it. So there are over 100 Hasidic yeshivas in Brooklyn and Muncie and Kiryas Joel. I think approximately 137.
So
Seems like a lot more with all the school buses
taxation,
around here.
And the tax department says there's like 500.
and you have up to like probably 40,000 boys attending those yeshivas.
We're not even talking girls now. We're just talking boys.
Just the boys alone. So you have tens of thousands of boys attending those yeshivas. On average, a Hasidic yeshiva, and I mean, and this applies probably to 90 to 95% of these yeshivas, they provide 1.5 hours a day of English and math to kids up till the age of 13. At that point, in most yeshivas, the boys get cut off completely from any secular education. It's not uncommon for boys to attend 12 or even 14 hours a day in yeshiva and not receive even 1 minute of secular studies. Not English, not math, let alone science, history, geography, music, and arts, and so forth. These are all subjects that are actually required by law, even for non-public schools to provide. There's actually a misconception. People say, well, they're private schools, they could do whatever they want. Actually, it's not like that. Imagine if someone said, well, it's my car, I can drive as fast as I want. It doesn't work that way. You have a school in New York State, you have to abide by
certain rules. So how have they been getting away with it for so long? It's so simple.
So it's actually, that's a good question. And obviously you could say, well, you know, the black vote, that's the easy way to
what?
They have a black vote. You can say
black vote?
A black vote.
A black.
Yeah. Meaning, you know, the government looks the other way. But I think it's a little bit more nuanced than this. If you think about it, these are non-public schools, private schools. Does that sound like something that would provide an inferior education?
No. If anything, when should
think,
be better.
Exactly. When you think of private schools, you think of good schools, schools where people actually pay money. Instead of sending their kids to free public schools, they send them to private schools where they're going to get a good education. So it makes sense that the government took a step back and said, private schools, we don't need to worry about them. We have a hands full with the public schools. Let's focus on them, right? You know, and people always say, oh, public schools aren't doing that such a great job either. And I believe Ezra Friedlander actually recently said that.
Oh, wow. Shocking.
Yeah. So you know, the problem is...
Well,
that's true. So what people...
But you know what?
People fail
how
to realize,
bad the public schools do...
Exactly.
They still give them so much... I was a teacher in eighth
and
grade.
And education. It may not be great, but it's something.
Like, they teach you the basics. Yeah. English, math, history. Yeah. If you want, you can at least pick it up. Right. But if you go to Hasidic Yeshiva, you're not even going to get it.
You don't even have the option if you want it. You know why Friedlander is doing that? Because Friedlander is one of Greenfeld's little cronies, and they're going to give away the whole sanitation department on 19th Avenue. Him and Pearlstein, they're going to give it to Satmar because they're paid off.
I'll tell you the truth. I'm supposed to meet with Pearlstein tomorrow.
Oh God!
So I'm not gonna bash him just yet.
Bash him,
I want to hear what they have to say.
Zero.
You know?
Whatever comes out of their mouth, just remember one thing: it's not true. I'm telling you, especially Pearlstein.
When I look at all the funding,
unless you can drop off a couple dollars on the floor there, let him pick it up. You'll see how quickly. Go ahead.
When I look at all the tens of thousands of dollars they inject into these private schools like UTA, Krasna, I saw some of the numbers that go through the Greenfield's office. You know, I think he needs to understand that the money needs to be put to good use.
How much?
Lots of money.
How much?
At least 20,000.
Per person?
No, not per person. I'm saying, you know, to these schools, he...
$20,000?
Yeah.
Whoop-dee-doo.
No, but you're talking, he does it to
We're
many
talking about private schools.
These places have budgets of millions
no,
of dollars.
No, of course, no, of course. But generally, funding comes from the state or from the city. You know, on a city level.
I know they get
But I'm
the
saying,
do you know that? Do you know that each councilman gets $1 million to give away to different charities
exactly.
every $1 million? He's not going to give it to one place. He's got to bribe a few different places, and that's what he does. He has to give it away. So does Heiken, our state senator.
You know,
our state assemblyman.
You know, is it?
You know what? The kickback is when they run for office, they get their support and they get money. I know that in Greenfeld's first election, they backed him and they lent him money, and he still didn't pay back a lot of the original debt that he owes out over there. You know what I mean?
He's a real politician.
He's a real politician. Yeah. And that's why Pearlstein and Friedlander are even in the office there, because he was chosen by those guys. You have a guy, Rabbi Handler. The man is a dumbbell. And the man, yes, he's a rabbi, but the man actually sits on the community board and votes for stuff that he's not qualified to. By the
way,
go
Simcha Felder, go. I love him.
I know. I like Simcha. He's a good man, but I haven't seen him do anything.
He's a state guy.
He doesn't even reply to emails. Today he was sent an email. The guy called me up. I'm sending Simcha Felder an email. I said, send it to me. Reply. The guy did not reply.
What was the address on it?
I don't know. They called
his
office. His district?
No.
Yeah,
the guy who sent
Borough Park person. And Heiken didn't reply, but Greenfeld replied in 3 seconds. Said, call the office, we'll talk. Even though I know Greenfeld won't do nothing, but Greenfeld is all scared and he does reply.
That's one thing he does do. But I have a question for you. I was a teacher in Krasner, and I have a couple of boys who did make it good. But yeah, by eighth grade, those kids didn't even know how to read. I was teaching them business. I was teaching them basic math division, and I was embarrassed. I was a teacher in Satmar one year in fourth grade where actually I was crying with them.
They,
you know?
First of all, they treat their secular teachers, the ones that actually do have some sort, they treat them like garbage.
Right.
I know that for a fact because my uncle used to teach them. He said they literally treated him like he's less than a piece of bread. That's what I'm saying. But let alone they literally don't even treat them like human beings.
Right. Let me tell you a little bit about the history of the whole teacher situation. So I don't know if you remember in the past, like many years ago, 15, 20 years ago, or like 20 years ago, they used to hire a lot of public school teachers, right? So after the public school teachers were done in public school, at 3 o'clock, they would come to the yeshivas and teach over there from 3:30 to 5, right? That was actually very common. So it was non-Jews, modern Jews who taught in public schools. But then there was this transition into hiring ultra-Orthodox teachers. So at some point, they had teachers like you teaching in Krasna and Satmar. So even though you're not a Satmar guy or a Krasna guy, they would hire you, right? So the modern Jews would be able to both teach, and they were Jewish.
No, but we would also understand our people, and we weren't exhausted from dealing with children. And the more,
have you ever taught in Belz?
I didn't teach in Belz. I taught in Wien for a couple of months, mm-hmm. but Satmar was 2 years when I was going through school. Krasner was really, I worked with a lot of those boys, did go on to do some good businesses, and I'm still friendly with mm-hmm. a lot of them. A lot of them did well, and I was so proud that some of them do good. Right. You know, today I taken a lot of interns in my expediting. I teach people the business because they don't have a thing. And if you're a proper teacher and you're a good educator, right. which I believe I am, you can teach people to not only go drink from the water like a horse, but actually to feed themselves later on. Yeah. Well, I believe these yeshivas don't do that. And yeah. you're right. I know today I have a couple of clients who are screaming, oh, you're going to go after these yeshivas and not educate them. Those people are idiots. What do you mean have faith that God will give you a living? Unacceptable. Stop it. Stop it.
Says it, by the way, in Jewish law.
Yeah,
that you don't have a right to say
to rely
on God,
on a miracle, right?
for living.
Well, you have to do your establish,
right? You have to do your work.
You can't just get thrust into the world with no education.
So God will provide. You have to know the basics.
So we have 40,000 children coming through the next generation that are going to be ignorant, stupid idiots.
Well, those are your words.
They are. They're exactly. Anybody who doesn't graduate high school is an idiot.
You go through Borough Park. Let's talk to
Did we ever answer the question from before? Man. The question was, why are they opposed to it? Is it a religious thing? Is it that they just feel like they don't need it? Because what is the reason why they don't want it?
Right. So there are different people have different opinions about this. I hear from people, you know, that this is a way for the leaders to control the population. They keep them ignorant. This way they can't go out there on their own.
Oh, I can't believe that.
A lot of people use that. I don't agree with it, but a lot of people use it. Look, as far as I'm concerned, I think the main reason they don't teach a proper secular education is because they think they don't have enough time. It says, V'hagisa bo yama v'layla, on the Torah, right? So they feel like they have to dedicate as much time as possible to studying the Torah, and they simply feel like they don't have time to teach secular studies. I think that's a foolish approach.
I don't agree with that approach either. I think that what I believe is that they believe that the secular world is a bad world, and we keep the bad people away. And if the kid goes home to study his books by himself, that's fine. But again, you can't do that. Not every kid can, because I see a lot of the chassid. I have a young girl who's a special ed teacher in my office. She rents an office. A wonderful, beautiful woman, and this girl takes kids that are learning disabled, physically disabled. She talks to them and cries with them and screams with them. And I see the maturity, and I see the growth. And I couldn't even do that for a half an hour. This girl does it day after day after day. If we actually care about our kids and try to do it the right way, just like we taught the Torah and we don't hurt our children, I believe that these Hasidic kids can do well. Yes, you can keep some Absolutely. Of the secular world out of it, but there's basic stuff. I know that what's called a spinker is trying to put in QuickBooks and computers into their world of English and try to teach their kids better. But yeah,
used to be they all taught math.
Right. But no, only
that was very important.
But only till eighth grade.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, after eighth grade, there is no English. And even Bob have stopped their English after eighth to 12th grade. Right. Unacceptable.
Right.
Unacceptable. And what are you doing about it, Naftuli? You can't do anything. You can't fight them. You can't scream at them. Can we protest one after the next? Can we embarrass them? Can we make them lose their government funding? Because all these schools get, what are they called?
They get a lot of different types
not
of
only grants, but not only grants, you know, when you scholarships.
Right.
They get scholarships. Take it all away from them. Don't let them make a profit.
Uh-huh. Well, you know, the truth is we're trying not to target the yeshivas directly, but rather to focus our attention on the Department of Education for failing to enforce the law and for failing to oversee those yeshivas.
I still don't understand how it's even possible.
Exactly. You see, it doesn't make after any all, sense I agree with you. It's very infuriating that the yeshivas are doing this. But after all, it's the Department of Education who should have been doing something about this. They shouldn't have neglected these non-public schools, especially since
we informed them
3 years ago. We informed them. Me and my colleagues, we met with those people, both on a state level and on a city level. What did they do since then? Nothing. So we had to go all the way till we basically sent a letter, you know, came from our lawyer and signed by 52 former students, parents of current students, and former teachers. And that's the only way they finally listened. Now they're saying they're going to do it. They're going to conduct an investigation. So at first they said their investigation is going to consist of a questionnaire that they're going to send the yeshivas, and the yeshivas are going to have to respond to it. And based on that, they're going to decide if the yeshivas are
complying. Oh, please, they can lie in a second.
Of course. So that was my first response. But later I heard that they're going to actually have a more serious investigation. They're going to need to see some actual documentation.
Well, don't they give tests every year? I thought every school has to take the regions.
Non-public schools don't have to give the regions.
But shouldn't non-public schools have failing grades, like public schools,
they
should be
report.
Shut down?
They don't need to report.
It's
unfortunately,
not right. It's not right.
So you're right.
That's
and this is
system.
Why. And that's
is there regulation? Is there not regulation? Make up your mind.
Yeah. So that's why that's exactly what we're trying to change, that there should be more consistent oversight. They shouldn't wait. See, as of this moment, the rule is, the law is, or whatever, that people need to complain about the yeshiva system and about a specific yeshiva. That's the only time they'd look into it, right? That needs to change. There should be consistent oversight. Now, you know, one thing...
Well, I have a question for you. We have to... we're going to tell everybody, we're going to take a caller because we want to have somebody talk to you. For let's
we are the Just Enough Heshy
Show. Just Enough Heshy Show. If you want to talk, call in and talk to Naftuli Moster, 718-303-9090. We have Esty on the phone. We want to put Esty and the caller on the phone together at the same time. So we're going to take Esty and I think we're going to take Victor. I don't know whatever your name is. I'm sorry. I apologize. I can't see the screen. I'm getting old. Naftuli, I think that's because my eyeglass guy didn't go to high school and he gave my thing. Are we going to put Esty on? Do you know how to do that, producer? Oh, Esty!
Hey, what's up?
What's happening? We miss you, Esty. I'm not doing a good job with the advertising.
What?
Esty, I want to ask you a question.
How high are you right now?
Oh, I'm so super stoned. It's crazy.
I don't want to hear this, Esty. I don't want to hear this, Esty.
I mean,
stop
I'm
it.
So sober.
But it's legal.
No, but this guy with yeshivas, I spoke to the guy from the Omni magazine, right? After the show, I asked him why he would be against it. And he's saying that children, if their parents want to raise them a certain way, we shouldn't have a right to tell them how to raise their children. Which the problem is they live in our society. So
And then they go on.
They should not be allowed to live in our society if that is how they are. If they have their own community, maybe free of jail, but they don't expect money from the government, then sure, no problem. You can raise your kids that way. But otherwise, you don't have a right to put that on society.
Well,
which guy from Ami did you speak to? Was it Rabbi Frankfurter?
Rabbi Frankfurter, yeah.
Yeah, he was on the air.
Did you hear the story? How we put up billboards, advertisements around Brooklyn, Borough Park in Williamsburg, and you know, here these were the put up these billboards, and so we also put in that ad into Ami magazine.
Can you translate? They're in Hebrew. I can't see.
I'll tell you later about it. Yeah. Anyway, we put it into Ami magazine. So within 24 hours later, Frankfurt has sent out an apology for putting in the ad. Now read the ad. The ad is basically a phrase from the Talmud. It says Chayav Adam Lalamed Esbenoi Imnis, which means a father must teach a son a trade. And we all know that the yeshivas are now considered a messenger for the father. And then it says it's your mitzvah, it's the law, and then that's it. Yafed. And they basically recanted the ad, if you will.
Doesn't it go longer that your child will be a thief?
If you don't teach your son a trade, he could become a thief. Yeah.
Well, look at what's happening. It's true. In different ways.
Esty.
They're not robbing people, but they are stealing.
Esty.
Yes, hi.
Your brother grew up Hasidic and went to the Hasidic schools, right?
The reason why he knows English very well and math because my mother used to teach it to him at home.
How did she learn?
No, the girls' schools are amazing. They I think every single one of them teaches math, science, all that.
Because they expect the women to go out and work for their husbands.
No. They don't consider it the Torah, you know, like a waste of time. But what they don't get is math, science, all that is in the Torah. So it's learning something, even if it's not specifically Torah, can still be considered learning because there's a lot for us to learn. If you want to read a book on inspiration that someone wrote, they don't consider that biblical Torah because it has to do with the Torah. So math, science, all that is in the universe. So it's not, it's your mind working.
Esty, what are you, rabbits in there?
Wow,
that was nice.
I'm just saying, I'm trying to describe why it's important.
I know, right? Esty, we love you, Esty, and thanks for calling into the show as always. You're just delicious.
No, stop it.
You want to hang up on me, Esty.
If
I'm not there, I'm not part of it.
Esty, you're a part of it, and I want to ask you, so what kind of brands did you have?
Oh, stop it. Esty, you better get back to the show. Otherwise, I'm going to have to fine you on your no salary.
What was your favorite chocolate in Colorado?
Oh, we didn't have chocolate. You know, they're probably OU. Remember, they made legal?
I don't want to hear this, Esty. I love you, Esty. You better come home quickly. You know, we have a rafting trip Sunday, so I expect you back for the rafting trip.
Yeah.
Esty, bye, sweetheart. Cool. We'll see you Friday. Bye-bye, baby girl.
Okay. Bye.
Bye-bye, Moister. We're going to take a phone call for you. Line two, go ahead. You're on the air with Uncle Heshy and Naftuli Moster and the crew of the Just Enough Heshy Show. Go ahead.
Okay, so, you know, when you're reading the Torah in Hebrew and when you're reading the Torah in English words, it's totally different. When you're actually reading it in the Hebrew language, and if you know how to speak Hebrew, everything makes more sense. So they're not going to look at English or math or science, because when you're actually learning the Torah, you're getting that information faster than if you're learning somebody speaking the way they speak. So how are you learning math in the Torah?
Where? Masechtas?
Everything. Listen, I didn't read the whole Torah, but there's everything in the Torah that has to do with math, teaching you how to live, how to be a better person, how to even do math, how to work with things that even English, you have to go to masters. After masters, they still won't teach you because you have to have experience.
Can you tell us which yeshiva you went to?
I went to Kings Bay. I'm in New Zealand and Bedford.
Did you have an English education to 12th grade?
I only went to yeshiva for about 2 years. So I have English experience.
Where did you go the rest of the time? Only for 2 years in yeshiva. Where did you go until?
I went to Red Hill Public School.
So you went to public school, and you can come up here on the air. I mean, here's the thing: you probably don't understand what we're talking about when we say that the yeshivas are not providing a proper education. We're not saying.
I'm not talking about the proper education. What I'm talking about is the fact that you're saying that a lot of the Jewish people are teaching the children only Judaism or only how to learn Hebrew, how to learn stuff.
And you came on here to tell us that everything is in the Torah. I get it. Some people would say that. The fact is that in today's society, you need to get a good English, math, science, history, and geography education in order to be able to just get along with the rest of society. It's that simple.
To know history, it's fine. You can learn history anywhere. But to actually learn how to be a person, which is the Torah, actually.
That's great.
When you're reading the Torah and you're reading the Seder and you're into it seriously, it fixes you as a person.
Sure.
Okay, I cannot say the same about the English language.
We all
okay, you can read any English language, any writer in the past, and it's not going to be the same if you read one sentence from the Torah. That's just how it is. It's not because, you know, I did an experiment on myself. You could do it on yourself if you want. But that's just how it works. If you have a question about life, you're not going to get it from regular English.
Victor, I want to ask you a question. Where do you live? What neighborhood?
Brooklyn.
Is there nice buildings where you live?
Yes.
Are there decent roads where you live?
No.
What does that have to do with anything?
I'm going to explain to you something. I'm going to explain. So the guy, the rabbi that sits behind that doesn't learn English, do you think he knows how to build the building to be an architect? Oh, I'm sorry. Let me go a step further. Wait. I am. The Torah does not teach you to be an architect. The Torah does not teach you to shore up ground underneath that nobody should die. The Torah did not teach half of those doctors in the hospital that I saw loving and taking care of sick people today to make them better. Yes, you had one guy, the Rambam, which I don't even believe there was even a real doctor, but let's just clear that up. I'm just trying to explain to you something, that there's so much education that if we don't teach our children to be educated, children the secular education, you're going to kill us and you're going to wipe us out. And what's going to happen is we're going to have disease and sickness and decloding. And what's going to do is you're going to give all the good jobs away to what? To your immigrants that you're all bitching about.
And you should
about.
Just know that the Gemaras, and which is the Talmud, that do have math, they do not teach that in yeshiva. They do not.
Wow.
It's very difficult stuff. They don't teach it.
Yeah, they stick to the very basic things.
Right.
That's true.
Right.
So
that's a fact.
But Victor, do you believe that even an hour of English in a yeshiva is good enough? Do you think they should not be learning at least 3-4 hours a day of proper?
No, I never said that. No, I never said that. What I'm trying to say is that listen. We are the Jewish people. We have to. We have rules. Okay, we're not like everybody else. We have to follow certain rules. Other people can do whatever they want, but we have to follow certain rules. And the Torah is a way for us to get to better ourselves. I think this is what one of their main points, why they say we don't have time for nothing else, because we have to better ourselves, because that's what we've been told to do. So it's not true. When you are, if you do speak Hebrew and you do understand the words in Hebrew, and you're reading passages, Seder or Torah, you understand it differently than if you read it in English. It could take you a lifetime to read in English where you could understand if you actually knew how to speak Hebrew and understood the words.
Victor, thank you for your call, Victor. I appreciate it so much. And keep listening to this. Do you like our show, Victor?
Yes,
good. Thank you.
Think about it for a minute.
I'm going to play devil's advocate. Okay, he's right. What do you want for my life? I don't want to read the English. The Torah solves all my problems. I can have a job. I can go on a spaceship. I am smart enough that with the Torah, me and my 40,000 other kids, we don't need you. Who are you, Rabbi Moster? I think you're whacked. I don't need an education.
Sorry, it's kind of hard to imagine you as the devil's advocate after you just gave that whole speech to that guy.
But don't worry.
But the guy doesn't seem to understand you.
Well, the fact is
the guy seemed a little bit off.
Well, you know, the guy doesn't realize how lucky he is. When he hears something about education in yeshivas, he doesn't realize what we're talking about when we say that the kids are not getting a basic education. He went to public school for most of his life, and then he went to some school in Bay Ridge where I'm assuming he got a thorough secular education. So he's not even able to grasp the problem. And you know what? He's not completely wrong. What I'm trying to say is a lot of people, and I encounter a lot of people, you know.
But how hard is it for me to take a mouse? How hard is it for me to take a mouse and click an icon and say, hey, boom, I got mail? You know, and that fact that today the mail could be translated into English, Spanish, and different languages. So who needs you, Rabbi Moster?
Well, you know, just checking your mail alone is not going to get you, is not going to make you a living. So people need different skills. You need an intro to let's say even just an intro to science to get around, an intro to history and to geography. Just learning the basics. These are not like negotiables. These are things that every employer expects their future employees to know.
But I'm not looking to make a lot of money. I don't want to be smart. I'm willing to sweep the streets the rest of my life and make and live in a corner basement.
Well, most people within a community are not, they have large families. They do need to provide for a large family. So they don't have the luxury of saying, you know, I don't need a large income, because after all, they do rely heavily on government assistance. I don't know if you know, people in Borough Park and Williamsburg rely more heavily on government assistance than families in Brownsville and Bed-Stuy.
Wow.
You know this? Yeah.
Did you hear that,
percentage-wise,
Neil?
Percentage-wise.
Oh, yeah. I know that.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So it's unfortunate, and you
they
know
every system and
it doesn't
program.
Look it doesn't look good for us Jews. It doesn't bode well for us.
But you're not only into the Jews. You're into everybody should get a proper full high school education.
Well, obviously, but my main
I believe that everybody should get a college education for free as well. I do. Why not?
Who's gonna pay for it?
We the government. That's right. We the people. Be my brother's keeper. That is the theme of the show. Be my brother's keeper.
Yeah, it's very good.
You really, really
You'll have to vote for Bernie Sanders.
Why
did
I lose it, Neil? Really why?
Lost.
Why can't I be good to my fellow?
In Russia.
In theory, it makes sense.
Russia.
Yeah.
Not even there now. You'll have to pay. But maybe China will give you an education.
Oh, jump in the lake. Can you? We're going to take a phone call. Line number four, Moster. This is going to be for you. Go ahead, Monica. Hello, are you there, caller?
Hi.
Hi, you're out there. Go ahead.
Hi, everyone. So I just wanted to mention, somebody was talking to me about this, and they told me how it used to be that there was just one person who was learning, and they were the child love, and they would be the one that would learn everything inside out, and everybody would go to them with
their questions. Correct.
And everybody, all the other men in the town worked. There was no such thing as like having half the town working and half the town learning. It was one person learning and everybody
How long
else
ago was this and where?
And I'm not too sure exactly, but if you like even think about, you know,
time
days, like how long ago was that? Mm-hmm. You know, he was the one learning and everybody else pretty much was working.
Well, I disagree with you, Monica. I do like to learn too a little bit in the morning, but I'm saying let's not learn a whole day. We're allowed to.
Exactly.
We're allowed to learn Japanese. I'm trying now to learn Japanese.
Why?
I don't know why. Somebody got me the CD tape and I really want to learn something different.
Is that
so
a
I want to keep, but I do want to work. My hours are busy. I disagree that we shouldn't give up the entire Jewish learning, but we should do a very serious secular education. And it should be forced.
So my point was basically that today people think that it's okay for everybody to be just that Rav who's the Bodek and everything, and for every single person to be the Chafetz Chaim, and really we can't survive in a society like that.
And it was never like that before in history.
Right.
Do you know in Israel today, there's like 150 to 200,000 people who quote unquote sit and learn. And I want you to know, never in Jewish history has so many people warmed benches before. Never.
And I want to point out that might not even be a good thing as far as, you know, presenting a Jewish image to the world, and as far as being contributing,
it's not a good thing. That's my point.
Not leading off the government and being viewed, and this is how anti-Semitism.
That's my point. That's exactly my point,
Monica.
That is ridiculous. It's absurd to tell everybody to go sit and learn.
Monica, when you have children, or if you have children, are you going to make sure that they have the secular education? And I'm not talking an hour or two. Are you going to fight to get them a good education?
Of course, I plan on having many children, and I plan on making sure that they get the best secular education that they can, so that they can be whatever they want.
But your rabbi and husband is going to say, no, sweetheart, I want them to be in yeshiva all day and let them have an hour on the side, or if you want, go learn
with
them.
Well, I'm not marrying that kind of person, because I want my children to have an open teacher, and when you don't teach them when they're young, it's a lot harder to learn when you're older. When you were young. So if you don't teach them when they're younger, basically closing off most of their options for when they're older. So first of all, hi Naftuli, I'm a big supporter of you,
as you know. Thank you, Monica.
Hi. And it's one of my favorite organizations, which is why I tuned in the first place.
Oh, thanks.
But yes, this is a very, very big issue. And if you don't teach the kids when they're young, the chances of them being able to learn when they're older are minute.
And it shows in a place like Lakewood, where there are people that after 5 years or 7 years, whatever the number is, they finally figure out that, hey, it might be a good idea if I go to work.
Right.
And then they go out there. And literally, they go from job to job to job. They can't get above whatever it is an hour. And they have no real value. Yes, some of them are very good businessmen.
Right, so I think that's
own.
A really big problem, actually. The fact is that some people do have a Jewish hookup.
Right.
Some think that I'm using a very loose way, but there's a lot of places, like personally, I got hired because I was Jewish. And a lot of places will hire Jews and help promote them even without an education. So those particular people who are getting pushed up because they're Jewish make everybody else think that, oh, it's okay if I don't get an education. I'm Jewish. I'll make it. But that's
right. Like everyone points that the owner of B&H
is
Well, B&H, I don't have any respect. I never buy any products from B&H. He likes to deal with he deals with a lot of rats, even bad Jews who hurt other Jews. But since they, the community exists.
Whatever, but there are other successful Jewish people who have not got a college.
I hope being age goes out of his hands.
But there's an exception, not the rule.
Like the guy who recently sold his business to Microsoft for like $39 million.
But this is the exception, not the rule.
But I just want to add something to what Monica said. So less than an hour before I came on the air.
Well, Monica, thank you for your call, Monica. By the way, Monica, did you finish high school?
No, actually, I'm in college.
Good girl. Good. You're allowed to do that, and I'm very proud of you.
What is that called?
Congratulations.
GED, and you don't even need a GED.
Not GED. A SCEP? What is it when you do college
at home?
A GED.
I do GED, actually.
But it doesn't make a difference. Okay. High school, as long as you can do private tutoring and go into college. College is not a requirement to have a high school diploma.
Right.
You've got to go through it, and if you want to be educated,
well,
Monica, I'm so
it will make it much harder. I'm telling you that all the people who don't get high school diplomas because their yeshivas won't give it to them or because they didn't actually get an education, I only got accepted into one college because I had a GED, and I have a perfect score in all of my classes. I'm not a dumb person, but I only got accepted into one.
Which college are you in?
I'm in Kingsborough right now.
I love Kingsborough.
You can transfer.
They are great, and Touro happens to be. Everybody makes fun of it, but I love Touro.
Monica,
Touro
I was
a lot of people.
Monica,
well,
I was once.
Options are very limited because I could have been going to Columbia.
Monica, I was.
I'm not complaining. I'm just saying that when you close people off an education when they're younger, they're going to struggle when they're older.
Just Monica, just to let you know, I started off in Mahala Parnasa, which is Touro. Then I transferred to Kingsborough. Then to the College of Staten Island, and then in graduate school, I went to one of the top schools in social work.
That's
so
amazing.
There's still hope for you.
Which one is
that?
Monica, thank you for your call.
There's no hope for you, Monica.
I know you're not a regular listener, but now I hope you become a regular listener.
There's no hope for you, Monica.
I want to add something to what Monica said. So this was less than an hour before I came on the show. Someone sent me this message. I'm a member of the community, so needless to say that I need my identity, contact, and communication to be private. First off, I need to thank you personally for all your efforts and work on our kids' behalf. I don't know whether you'll be successful to the last detail of what we'd want, but you certainly are putting the focus where it should be. By the way, I hold a graduate degree today and earn almost $200,000 a year.
Wow.
But the pain and years it took to get here, to get there was unbearable. So this is coming from a Hasidic guy who finally made it. You see, this is what I find a lot. People who are actually successful, you know, you would expect the people who are successful to say, you see, I made it without an education. But it's actually mostly those people who come out and tell me that they support Yafed because they know how much farther they could have gotten had they had that elementary
or
high school education.
Sure, it takes them an extra 5 years to even be an electrician.
At least, yeah.
No, I'm saying even a trade, plumber, to understand, you know, cost and expenses, overhead, you know, all these kind of things. It takes them time, you know. In the beginning, they're just cash flowing. You
right,
know, everybody's
right.
just cash flowing. But to end up with a profit, they don't even know how to, you know, judge if they're making money because they always have money because they're always turning it.
Right.
That's all.
Well, everybody, we're going to take another caller for Naftuli Moster, but I'm going to have to, even though I lost my paper, I think you stole it from me. We're going to have to tell everybody what show they're listening to. Can you do that for me while I look for my paper?
What, the Justin of Heshy show?
You're listening to the Justin of Heshy show.
At 6:20 a.m. on your dial.
Right, Monday and Tuesday nights, we're on, where you can get us live on YouTube by typing in Justin of Heshy. And
by the way, don't forget who follows us, Ralph Romeo.
Oh, right.
Ah.
Ralph, I forgot that. Ralph is a great,
wonderful person.
Wonderful person.
A really mensch.
But he's not only a mensch, he's a humanitarian. See, because I'm not properly educated.
Humanitarian.
And humanitarian, he's a wonderful man. I love
and
him.
And he's really sincere. He's
yeah.
really,
no, I
you know, the last few days, he's on the show. He's been talking about one of his relatives that a doctor hooked him up with psychiatric drugs and stuff, and how much damage it did.
Right.
You know, because they just give it out like candy.
But he's besides that, he always answers me in the morning with a good. Again, another man who takes his time to be kind to another person. You're
right.
Listening again to the Justin of Heshy show. You can get us on YouTube by typing in Justin of Heshy. You can get us on email by typing in justinofheshy@gmail.com. Yes, we answer every single email. You can call into the show at 718-303-9090. Our last show this season is September 8th, before the holidays. It's going to be a big bang-up blast of a show because me and Neil are going to have a big bad fight, trust me.
Oh, boy.
And then season two starts on October the 12th. Mr. Clean, one of my favorite guys, Mr. Clean.
Chaim?
Mr. Clean delivers, we know him for many years. Pick up and drop off. Mentioned just enough as you're showing, you get 25% off. 347-369-3051. Come on, guys, use him. He could use the business and really does a great job. Black Label Electric Cigarette. Quit smoking. I'm trying, babies. I'm trying.
Yeah, you did it for years.
BL Premium. PREMIUMESIG.com or call Mikey 561-239-8941. You buy 10, he gets one for free. It's like 20 cigarettes, whatever it is. Green Line Building Solutions. We do asbestos and lead inspections, DOB, HPD code compliance, stop lift orders, free consultations. Call 718-871-0382. We have a nice staff. We try our best to love you and get you to the finish line. Anyways, we got another call for you, Naftuli. We're going to take a call on line one. You're on the air with Uncle Heshy and the crew and Naftuli Moster.
Yeah, hi. I just wanted to play the devil's advocate for a second. I don't really believe that having a full secular education will guarantee anybody's success.
No guarantees in anything.
In addition, so much of the secular education is quite frankly a waste of time. Learning history, Spanish, art history, and all these other topics that they teach in high school is not going to get you anywhere unless you're going to become a teacher or a professor in that area of learning. So maybe teaching the basics of math, multiply, subtract, divide, adding, or just plain English, how to write a sentence, that would be enough to get by, especially in the type of businesses that community engages in. And most of them are engaged with either nursing home businesses or retail businesses or manufacturing. And they don't need to have a full-blown secular education.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Nursing home now requires education and classes. Construction now needs to have licenses and testing.
But all these companies are started by people who had the education. Somebody has to do it.
Right.
Construction. If they're not going into construction, they don't need geometry and calculus and all these other.
Hold on.
Tell me one business today that does not need an education. Just give me one business that doesn't need an education.
What he's saying is, though, that you know, when they teach you all these different subjects in high school or even in college, like intro to Spanish and things like that, he's arguing that it's completely useless. So now I want to respond to that. So when they give you this very broad education, what they're hoping is that you, as an individual, you'll pick up on what you specialize in or what speaks to you, and then you'll advance in that field. So if, let's say, you in high school, you learn English, math, history, geography, music, art, you'll find one of those that really, really works for you, and then you'll pursue it further. But if you don't learn that in high school, then you don't even know where to start, where to begin when you're 20 years old, you're married now, you have a kid on the way, and you have to provide for your family. That's what we're trying to change. In elementary and high school, they're supposed to provide you with a very general education so that you have an idea of what you want to pursue later.
And by the way, I know a guy who was a shoemaker. He couldn't speak English. He makes shoes. It's a very decent profession. And all his life he's making shoes, and he put away money. He made money. Do you think the guy can even speak to his child? I see him look at his child in synagogue. The man looks ignorant to his child. He can't talk to his child about politics or anything. Because you're right, because he didn't do an education. Yeah, he knows how to make a nice pair of shoes. He knows how to do a little business. Education is not only to get a job. It's also to support your families, to make your mind, because if your mind is stupid, all you're going to do is get sick and think of yourself. Education is the most. God gave us an education. He gave you the Torah to teach you how to educate, how to learn to be educated. You know, God didn't give us gold or steel or metal or glass. He gave us the thoughts. He gave us
the mind,
the teaching on how to use the Torah to invent these items. And now you're building skyscrapers and planes. We're going to the moon. Come on. If you don't have education, I believe they close the yeshiva down. If the yeshiva, I'm telling you seriously, I believe that Yafit should go after these yeshivas. Yafet, shut down Satma. Shut down Krasner. They're building a big new building on the corner of 44th Street and 16th.
Been building it for 10 years.
10 years, but now they're getting close. Shut them down. Don't let them finish it till they promise to have 12th grade education.
You just explained the reason why they're being successful in the way they're going. currently. They're building million-dollar yeshivas. Obviously, somebody's donating that money.
They're stealing a lot of money from the government.
They're getting money. And they're tricking. You know what they're using? Hold on. They're using my guilt. They're saying, listen, Heshy, since you're not totally sophisticated and one of us, if you give us the money, and I swear to you, if you give us the money, God will forgive you for these things. I told you, when I was 21 years old, I did something bad. I mean, not bad to kill anybody, but something against God that I thought was a very bad thing. And I went to my rabbi and I said to him, listen, man, I feel guilty. I don't know what to do. I did a bad thing on this Shabbos, whatever. I can't get it out of my brain. He says, no problem, Heshy. He gives me a little piece of tillum to say. He says, every day you're going to say it twice a day and you're going to give me $2,000 and it's all forgiven. I says, wow, right away, quickly, I gave him $2,000 because I was an idiot. That's what you're telling me right
really?
Now.
You had $1,000 to give away at $2,000 at the age of 21?
I've been working since I'm 13. Baby.
I guess you got a good education.
Heshy was rogue.
I was putting out posters at middle of the night.
Oh, wow.
I was doing it all, baby.
And you had a secular education, and look what you did. So obviously the secular education didn't make you any smarter.
He got a partial secular.
You are so wrong.
And I just want to end, I don't know if Naftuli agrees or disagrees, but even at a minimum, there should be vocational in high school.
Right, right.
Even at a minimum. In other words, teach them plumbing, electric, something, carpentry. You know, there are a lot of things out there that people can learn a trade if they can. And one of the people,
the caller right now should agree with that because he's saying that we
and
should
also sports. Right,
and
also,
agree with
and
that.
Also sports. Instead of letting the guys go home and eat and dress and not don't let them run.
They did not.
When I was a counselor in Munkach, and they did not allow us to have baseball.
Right.
It was illegal, and the kids used to smuggle in their baseball goals, and I played with them. Unacceptable. Sports is so important. Very, very important. So anyways, we are healthy.
That's the same thing with the education. That's what
I'm talking about. And you have a youth heart disease just because you're Hasidish. You see this guy's 400 pounds eating chalom. Like, it's not.
But I want you to know there's a photo I have with Ezra Friedlander. Uh-huh. I have it somewhere right here with me. And Ezra Friedlander is in a photo with my favorite politician who I really despise most in the whole world. She is our first gay lesbian woman city council speaker.
Christina Quinn.
I'm going to show it to my public. And here he is, Friedler, hanging out with three little beautiful Jewish girls with a gay lesbian woman. And right next to him is who? Oh my God, Pilstein? Another winner. Hey, Greenfeld, did you support gay marriage? I'm sure you did. Oh, I forgot. You don't vote on it. Oh, let's go to hiking. Did you support gay marriage? You have state assemblyman. You got to support something. No, I didn't show up for that vote. Senator Felder, which I like you very much, where the hell are you? You're always hiding. God damn it. Pick up the phone call and call into the show. You know, Chaim Deutsch is the only one with a little class. I know you don't like him, Neil, but I like him. The man picks up every call. He calls everybody back.
He's a phone answering service.
He's trying.
To start.
I need to defend Mr. Friedlander here.
Oh, God.
I think what he did over there was just irrespectful thing to do. What's he supposed to do? Boycott the lesbian. What was she there? Council member? What was she at that time? She was a
speaker.
The speaker. You know, I think this was a respectful thing for him to do.
We have another picture where she walks into his house. Oh, yeah. Let's go hang out.
So what's wrong? He's a politician.
Yeah. No, I'm sorry. She went to the synagogue. A gay lesbian. Wow. You know what? Let's switch the whole synagogue into lesbian.
The real issue I have with Ezra.
My problem is that Miss Quinn was a pig. Forget that she hated her name.
Why was she a pig?
She was a pig. She wasn't.
Why? Because she wasn't heterosexual.
You know, Heshy, I'm not going
to lie. To the Jewish religion, you can't have it.
So, I have to call you out.
Pick a side, Friedlander.
No, first of all, there's no thing about women not being heterosexual.
Heshy, I have to call you out. I don't appreciate you calling anyone a pig.
I'm sorry.
It reminds me a little bit too much of Donald Trump. let's stay away from that.
And Bloomberg.
Yeah. But listen, the problem
is terrible.
Because you know what? Trump is going to raise our taxes.
The only reason why de Blasio couldn't bury this city yet is because Bloomberg put such a solid foundation.
Right, so he's bankrupting half of us. We're all going in the hole because he's raising our taxes, raising our prices, raising our fines.
He's a communist.
Communist. I'm driving 30 miles an hour in Ocean Parkway. I actually got a speeding ticket.
30?
30.
That's 31. Was 25
I'm sorry,
now.
31. I went 31.
Right. So six over?
Six
on
over.
On a six-lane, basically, highway, 25 miles an hour. Yeah. Hilarious.
It's not normal
and
today.
And they promised they wouldn't do
and
that.
And they promised they wouldn't do it. And right, and bus lanes. And make a right turn. If your blinker is not on, so the bus didn't see a blinker on, you got a ticket for being in the bus lane. Not a normal
thing. Well, I'm not happy about people who don't use blinkers. Okay, it's one of my
and you know what bothers me the
I
most?
I think it's hard.
You know what bothers me the most? The city decided to give away bike lanes. No rent-free bikes. They'll rent to pay for, which I have no problem with. You got to take away parking spots. Go use private land. Rent land from private landlords. Put it in front of their stores. Don't take away my street parking where it's free. Now I have to go pay $40 for while you make a profit with your bikes. This is unacceptable.
Didn't that start under Bloomberg, though?
Yes. Yes. Bloomberg is another wacko, retard, idiot that God will punish.
Oh,
I didn't call him a pig.
What happened? You didn't have
dinner. Bloomberg was the beginning of the end of the city. Let's
we're coming to the end of the show. We got to take another caller because
before you do, I just want to. It doesn't look like I'm going to get much time here.
My guys are not picking up the calls because they're playing with Tetris on their phones.
So I just want to put out there that we recently put up a hotline, a Yafet hotline, and the number is 646-350-0075.
Again,
646-350-0075.
And do you have a website?
We also obviously we have a website, www.yafed.org.
YAFFED.org.
What's the hotline for?
So the hotline is designed basically. It has very limited options at this time, but we're going to continue expanding it throughout the year. But at this time, you can leave a complaint about a yeshiva that your son is attending, and Yafed will try to address it. So, but this is so. First of all,
do you go to meetings with the yeshivas? Do you sit down with them and call them up?
We're gonna try as much as we can. I'm not gonna promise that yeshivas are gonna sit down with us, but I think I feel like they're warming up to us because you know when a lot of people within the community want to see change, I don't think they're gonna be able to ignore them.
Well, all you have to do is pay Ezra Friedlander, and he'll get you into all of it.
Right.
Right.
At least one meeting.
Right. And Pearlstein, now he'll show up anywhere, even at the liquor board for you, if you just give him enough money. We're going to take another call of you, at least one more before we get off the show. You're on the air with Uncle Heshy and Naftuli Moster and Neil and Z, my boy.
Okay. Hello. I hope everyone's doing well. I've been watching your show. I have a question for Rabbi Moster. Where does he think everything is going to end up, given the state of affairs now? What does he think the end goal to be? And what does he see will be the end? When? Where? Like, what exactly does he think will happen? Just as a logical that kind of thing. Thank you so much.
And do you think you're going to be able to accomplish your job?
So, yeah, let me respond to that.
We're expecting
to see improvement on a quality level and quantity. So first of all, quantity. First of all, we're expecting the yeshivas to increase the amount of time they dedicate to secular studies or to general education. So to at least 3 hours each day. And then we're expecting them also to teach more subjects. So instead of just teaching English and math, they should teach at least history, geography, and intro to science. And then they should also continue, as far as grades go, it should continue all the way through high school. So at least till the age of 16. This is what the law is, and they must abide by it. I mean, the law demands a lot more than that, but everyone understands that the yeshivas need to dedicate a lot of time to Judaic studies too. But this is a minimum that all yeshivas can and should obey. Then on a quality level, we're expecting teachers to be more competent. Right now, they're hiring a lot of teachers who themselves can't speak proper English or do math, let alone history, science, and geography. So we're expecting them to have teachers that are actually competent, trained in the field. And also the attitude towards secular education should be more positive because kids are not encouraged to be respectful to the teachers, to be appreciative
That's
of the
what
studies.
They need.
Exactly. So the attitude needs to change on several levels. I mean, the parents, the staff in the yeshivas, and then the kids all need to have a more positive attitude towards the general education.
Now, Tony, you are a godsend, an angel. I wish you the best in your bright. If there's anything that the Just Enough Heshy team and crew and Uncle Heshy could do for you. By the way, I'm a little disappointed at you. You have a Bernie Sanders campaign sticker on your computer. Are you crazy, man?
You agree with him on education.
I know. I'm a sticker myself.
He's running for Hillary.
I got a free sticker from him. What am
seems like anything to do with it.
You'll be listening to the Just Enough Heshy Show, guys. We'll be back Monday and Tuesday next week between 7 and 9 p.m. You can get us on Twitter by hashtagging me at Just Enough Heshy. That's the pound sign. YouTube us at Just Enough Heshy, and you can see our live any shows. Or just email me at Just Enough Heshy, H-E-S-H-Y, at gmail.com. Our last show again is on September the 8th. Season 2 begins on October the 12th. Mr. Clean Delivers is one of our sponsors. Pick up and drop off 25% off if you mention our show. 347-369-3051. Black Label Electric Cigarettes. Quit smoking. Don't go to the hospital, guys. I'm trying myself. I'm here with you. Mikey, 561-239-8941. Green Line, asbestos. We do asbestos, lead inspections, DOB, HPD, code compliance, plans, permits, stop work orders, free consultation. We'll try to help you to the finish line. Call me at 718-871-0832. Don't forget, we have a hotline by Yafed, 646-350-0075. Right after this show, we have Ralph Romeo's show. Listen to him. He's a cool guy. Cool dude. Muscle building. I think he over-muscled himself, but he's handsome anyways. Everybody, I am personally inviting you this Sunday to my barbecue. Look at my Facebook page where the barbecue is going to be. You can come rafting. Give an extra $5.
I got to see this.
And don't forget my friend, Marsh. He's home. I'm so happy you're better. Thank you for listening to the show, everybody. Come again next week. Esty will be back.
Thank you.